go live. Hello everybody and welcome to Encounter Roleplay. My name is Will and today I am back here with Rem. How's it going, Rem?
It's going great, going great. Glad we can finally bust this bubble that's been on the top.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. You can see some things are on the screen right now, and we'll talk about those in a little bit more detail in just a few seconds. But basically, Rim and I have been working on a thing for a little while now, probably a couple of months, maybe, all in all, that we've been planning to release this and finally get to talk about it. Plans are finally coming together, artist layout stuff, the writing, the production, and everything else. And basically, so as the title will suggest, we are doing a Kickstarter. We are taking a thing to Kickstarter, and what is it? I hear you cry. It is a D&D module. It is the Breath of Gorr that we're going to be taking to Kickstarter. Sounds exciting, right? Yes. Yes, it is. I hear you cry. It's a little bit different, though. We got a couple of unique, we think, ideas. Rem, do you want to talk about the kind of proposal, I suppose? The main kind of thrust of what we intend to be doing?
Yeah, essentially let's make a D&D module, but what can we do to make this one, I guess, stand out more so than the others?
Right.
And it kind of all began with, I had a lot of fun playing these introductory games for other RPGs, such as the Iron Kingdom's introductory game, the Edge of the Empire introductory game, and they came with pre-made PCs with already established backstories, and so essentially you can sit down, throw the character sheets out to your players, and just start the game. And I was thinking, what if we do that with D&D? Let's create a D&D module, make four PCs already, give them their backstory, all that stuff, give them to the players, and in the true sense of role-playing, make them play that role.
Yeah, and exactly.
With that, yeah.
I mean, you nailed it there pretty much. We're kind of calling it this quote-unquote boxed module, right? In the sense that it basically has everything that you would need within the module itself to sit down and play. So if you ever played any of those kind of the older editions of Dungeons and Dragons, we actually got like a board game with all the pieces that you need to play. Then it's similar to a Lost Mine of Phandelver idea as well. And whilst it says box, we don't actually intend currently to produce any like physical stuff, right? We want it all to be digital currently and to use Roll20 assets and PDFs and stuff like that because we don't want to overshoot, basically. We wanted to create something that was very doable. Yes, Nacho Stark was the one I was thinking of. But yeah, we wanted to do something that was quite achievable and, but at the same time, quite exciting as well. So we can go in and talk. We've got this document here full of our kind of ideas and our kind of project proposal, basically. And we wanted to be like pretty transparent about everything that we're doing in the Kickstarter when it comes to, you know, the writing, playtesting, artwork, all of those costs, basically. And the idea that we're going to go with, that we're currently running with, is that we're going to pay for everything up front. We're going to do all of the work up front and going to have everything basically ready. And then we'll go to Kickstarter to make up whatever art costs that we've paid for, whatever layout costs that we've ended up going for, and so on and so forth, basically. So once we actually go to Kickstarter, and the plan would be to go to Kickstarter around the month of June, so summer, somewhere around that time. We're shooting for June, my birthday. Excellent month. To then the Kickstarter and the product itself basically be already created and made, and then we're just going to Kickstarter to, you know, recoup any stuff that we've already invested into the project itself. It's a good question, Selden. What kind of price range are you guys looking at per adventure? We haven't fixed on a solid number, right? It's not going to be very much, you know. There's obviously, for Kickstarter, you get different tiers of pay, right? So you could go in at the let me move that down there, music's a little loud, come in at the very kind of early stage of something and, you know, just get a basic standard PDF or whatever, and then there'll be, you know, stretch goals, unlocks, the more that you want to put towards it. Of course, the plan is, of course, afterwards to put it onto drive-through RPG. Kickstarters tend to be at a discount for like the base product itself when you back on Kickstarter to get the product done. So it's possible that the drive-through RPG product, you know, be, I don't know, between anywhere between $0 to $5, you know, something around that sort of mark. We haven't really set on the exact figure right now. This is what my student loan is for. Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah, I mean, I've yet to pay back mine.
ERP University.
Yeah, that's right. To do the ERP way. But yeah, that's the kind of basic proposal. So we don't have an exact figure down yet, but you can be guaranteed anywhere between that sort of range for the actual, you know, basic set of PDF. And who knows, maybe there'll be extra little additions that we add in for stretch goals and stuff like that as well. But that is the current stand of or what we're looking at. Rem, do you want to talk a little bit about the adventure itself that we've talked about a little bit?
Yeah. When we're done with all this, I'm going to do a blog entry on the site.
Yes.
And I will upload this PDF so that you guys can look into it, peruse through it at your leisure.
Yeah.
Let me scroll on down. Let's see if we discussed concept. Let me go down to the setting. Since what we're looking for with setting is since we're kind of creating all of this and it's on drive-through RPG, you know, we can't really use what's considered D&D canon, you know,
right?
Which I'm sorry, guys, we cannot put Dritz in this adventure to everyone's
character ever.
Dismay. Best character ever. It's okay, we'll get you better. If some of you the ERP enthusiasts might remember, about 3 months ago is when we kind of did the first workshop of this,
right?
Where because we put the bare bones of this together during stream, and the chat were the ones who suggested things to do for this game. The initial idea was a prisoner of war ship that the PCs start on, and eventually they overthrow it, take over the ship, and then take that ship after the bad guys and take it over. And that seemed to be a good idea for a nice little one shot, maybe a two shot if you stretch out long enough. But what we have here, I decided to go with orcs. The PCs are all going to be some variant of orc or orc related. Guys, we've only really hammered out one of the PCs and maybe a couple others as well, but I wanted to get really into just, you know, that hardcore get in, fight, take out the bad guys. It just, you know, when you hand these players these character sheets and they see these big nasty orcs, you know, that just kind of puts them in that mode, you know, let's chop a head off or two. But storyline wise we have, let me see here, it's on page 2, I think, the bottom of that setting, that's where it is. Yeah, we have essentially several tribes of orcs have banded together under one banner called the Skull Nation. And the Skull Nation is now just taking over everything one by one by one. And they're drawing in all these other allies. It's just a bunch of nasty things happening. And the players themselves play these prisoners who are also orcs, or like I said, orc-related extremities. And they get put on this boat called the Breath of Gorr. Gorr, G-O-R-R, happens to be in this world the orc god of feasts, who is rumored to have ascended from the hells. And he's the one who has created this Skull Nation. They're all doing this for the glory of Gorr. But because the orc pantheon, like several other pantheons, has several gods, these other orc gods are very, very unhappy that Gorr has decided to make such direct influence on the mortal world. Kind of like in Greek mythology, how the gods wouldn't necessarily step in and, whoa, it's me, Poseidon, you're all dead.
It's your bro.
He would, you know, yeah, it's your bro Poseidon. maybe give some power to some mortals, or, you know, bless this. They wouldn't really go in and get their hands into it, unless it's Gorr, and that's a no-no. So you play these orcs who, they don't like this. They've been captured. They're resistors to a degree. And essentially, they're on the ship. They're planning to take it over. And the cool thing is that since we are creating these PCs, we create their backstories, what they hold dear to themselves. So you can do stuff like the captain of the ship, and it'll say maybe one PC's backstory. This PC was specifically captured by this captain. So he's got a grudge against this captain. And so this player, but we'll be playing this PC, and when he sees that captain, it's like, all right, guys, there's that bastard right there.
Yeah.
Because I've played little pre-made things like this where you have pre-made characters who have these established grudges, and we can make these established grudges since we make the PCs.
Yeah.
And it just creates, like, when my buddy playing the Iron Kingdom starter, we came across like a mini boss that was the one that killed his like clan.
Right.
We just like went after the guy, and it was just so cool, so thematic, and we just got very into it. And so I think we got like a good way to get the party together. I mean, you're all captives, let's bust out. But other than that, that's kind of like the basic setting of where it's all going to spill over from then out.
Right, right. Exactly. Hello, Mitch. See you soon. So basically you sign up and are given a character to play. Right, so the idea would be that you can join a session having never played before, and mm-hmm. here's your sheet. You know, here you go. Yeah, I'll twist me. So basically we're going to play this on Adventurous Anonymous one day. Yeah, absolutely, yeah. We'll end up playing this on a stream, of course. Most likely podcasts and other bits as well. I like the idea of having Drizzle Dostankin in the game as well.
Yeah, Drizzle like, Dostankin.
Sounds like a good plan. but I agree. Basically, you can sit down and have everything that you need to play and just sit down and start get going. But it's not only for the beginners as well, as Rem was mentioning, if you're a more veteran player as well, it's still be fun, would be the idea. Like, you're not just going through all this kind of like noob zone. But as well as being a challenge for more veteran, I guess, quote unquote veteran players. We're talking here in this the concept of that old D&D 3.5 basic game with Redgar and Lydda the halfling rogue and that not, and that's very much the kind of inspiration for what we're planning to do. What will we do without our drists? This is my favorite Caroline, and currently I don't have any idea what we can do. Fuck me. We could take a look at the kind of overall events that we're looking to put into the module itself. Spoiler alert. You can have a mixed experience group. Exactly. And the idea could be, it could be a great one shot. So if you've got a new beginner player joining your group, then you say, all right, let's sit down and play the Breath of Gorr. That player kind of, it's almost in between like a board game and D&D itself. So it's like a D&D light, I guess. Rem, do you want to have a talk through this set of events that we have planned for the adventure itself?
Yeah, the events themselves, a lot of them were suggested by Encounter Roleplay viewers, so we did incorporate a lot of those in. Basic rundown, and again, this is on the planning stage, so we might take stuff out, put stuff in, who knows. Our first event we have listed is a brawl, kind of below the decks. We figure, let's just start it out in the gate. There's all these prisoners cranked on there. It's not just the four PCs, you got others. Mm-hmm. And if this alliance of orcs is taking over anyone to resist them, including other orc clans, elvish groups, dwarven groups, you lock some elves and some orcs downstairs, some fists might go get thrown.
Mm-hmm.
So that's if we have for the bullet points in the brawl. We could have an NPC prisoner that starts the fight, and the PCs, they're just tired of this shit.
Mm-hmm.
The neat thing about this as well, and which I kind of have to sit down and think about this when calculating the character sheets, is when you're below the decks, they don't have their weapons. So we have to make like either a note on the character sheets, or just have the DM say, you don't have weapons, here's your attack, or you don't have armor, so whatever the stats are on the character sheet are different now. Yeah. Unless we start the characters off not armored, not with anything, and they gain armor as it goes on. And it says, that could be a thing we do as well.
That's true.
So that's like the first fight is, rough up some prisoners, and by doing that, they kind of establish themselves as, big dick on campus.
Right, right. And that's, important for a module as well, specifically for beginner players to have an understanding of basic combat,
And what better basic combat than swing fists?
Hit your fists and not too much.
Although, as you will see, with this first PC we have built out, not all of them are as unarmed as they appear. We'll get to that.
That is true. I figured a toy hut for following as well.
Our second bullet point, we have the riot. This is when these prisoners, they're a little upset. They want to take their ship over. This is essentially it's not really a mutiny because the prisoners are not crewmen. Right. But we want to kind of give the PCs different ways they can choose to take over the ship. The little ways I've listed is to take the ship by stealth. There can be ways that PCs can sneak around, take it as guards out one by one.
Right.
Take it by force. We could have that maybe they make an alliance with the NPC prisoners with them. They just, you know, dogpile everything. Our third bullet point, take down a couple of guards and arm themselves with the guards' gear, which is a neat idea that I like. You know, yeah. You can get like five unarmed dudes just dogpile somebody covered in plate with like a sword and shield.
Just go after
you
him.
Can, yeah, but just dogpile him and just, you know, hold him down, choke him out, take his gear, and then, you know, in the neck, go back to stealth. Well, now you look like a guard. I mean, they're all
right.
Orc controlled ship, the Breath of Gorr, and you're orcs. Or number four, steal back their confiscated weapons from the ship's armory. So that's where, like, you know, you maybe have this one character who's got, like, their family's weapons. Like, you know, they were, of course, confiscated when they were captured. And that could be their bond, maybe. So when they take over the ship, you know, they want to run into the armory,
yeah.
Find their weapon, and that weapon is just very, very good in their hand. Another idea I had is if they have, like, this weapon that's theirs, maybe a guard has it on. Because, you know, if you have like a +2
uh-huh.
longsword and you're captured and they take your stuff, hell yeah, one of your capturers are going to it's a good ass sword. I'm going to take it. Of course, this fight ends with like a boss fight against the captain, and the captain could be, you know, could be a gnoll, could be whatever. It's some kind of cool fight at the end,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I want maybe the captain to try and sink or damage the ship as he starts to lose. Maybe he
because he's a sore loser.
Yeah. That's right.
If I can't have the ship, then no one can.
Yeah, it's like, you know, I'm going to take my ship.
Yeah.
Just sink the whole damn thing and we're all dead. Or maybe not like sink it to, like completely sink it, but stall right. it. Like,
yeah, you'll
either blow something up, burn up the sails,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Throw all the orbs off the side, who knows.
Yeah.
So your third little bit is the repair. And these could be different ways that the party figures out how to repair the ship. If they don't, then they have either slow sailing or if their food doesn't carry over as long as it could, so they can get exhaustion or anything like that.
Yeah.
So that's their first idea.
Yeah, I like that as well. Yeah, having different ways to solve problems as well as mm-hmm. just, you know, not just having combat. It's definitely what, you know, I certainly enjoyed when I was beginning to play D&D, you know.
Yeah.
Problem solving, you know, is a big thing.
So it's like, okay, guys, what's going on? The ship, we're boned.
Yeah.
What can we do? What do you guys?
Man
do
overboard! I wonder how many groups have just jumped overboard.
Tom makes us say, what am I doing here, Ron?
Oh, what am I doing here, JJ?
Yeah, JJ, I don't like you calling him Ron. JJ, what am I doing here?
Maybe his real name is Ron. Secretly Ron from Harry Potter.
I know, I keep thinking that the quote has Ron in it. Anyways, number four, and the fourth event, this is one that I was quite happy with.
Mm-hmm.
One thing in the lore with this Skull Nation, in the setting, I decided, well, instead of just being orcs, to kind of mirror how a rising powerful nation would be in real life,
right.
Eventually they would catch the eye of another powerful nation.
Yeah, makes sense.
Or city-state that wants to maybe throw its hat in the ring with them.
Yeah.
So we have this one faction called the Spires of Kunrakus, which is a mountain range ruled by red dragons. And so this group of red dragons has thrown their hat in the ring with the Skull Nation.
Mm-hmm.
So now there are dragons and orcs to worry about. So think of like this orc, like Sauron from Lord of the Rings.
All right.
His orc army. Now they've got some big, giant, good old school D&D red dragons. They got a bunch of Smaugs working for them. So this idea that the red dragon encounter. While the PCs are sailing, a red dragon from the Spires of Kunrakus lands on their boat. She believes the PCs who have taken over the boat are Skull Nation members, and she demands contribution from her allies. This is a dragon. It's weary, it's tired, it's been fighting. Oh, it sees one of its allies' boats. Well, I'm going to land there.
Yeah.
And in typical dragon fashion, hey,
give me some food.
Yeah. Give me your shit. Let me chill out for a while. And so I think I have the bullets say the party can fight off the dragon, which is one, dangerous, since she's a dragon.
Right.
Two, possible, since she is tired and weary. And
so,
since
we kind of scale the encounter almost, you know, oh god, red dragon, they're all going to die. Well, you know, it's a super tired one.
Yeah, she's just worn out. And three, exciting, since she's a dragon, who doesn't like fighting dragons? Or the party can just weather the dragon's demands and pretend to be Skull Nation members and just, you know, take in her abuse. Like,
right.
Okay, guys, we gotta pretend that we're these guys. we gotta pretend that, you know, we're bad guys and just deal with her for a bit. Maybe she won't catch on. And then maybe by doing so, they can get some information out of her. And that can test the party's, you know, ability to deceive, to lie, to and maybe just get information out. And then when she's done, she can either fly off or they can somehow choose to, I don't know, maybe there's a way to poison her or something with the food they give her. So there's all these ways to deal with that particular encounter.
Yeah.
And of course, it's D&D. Let's put it in the dragon.
Yeah. you gotta have it. I mean, if there's dungeons, there has to be at least one dragon per dungeon.
Yes, it's not dungeons and or dragons.
Exactly. Common mistake.
the ultimate then goal after taking over the ship is the ship was originally taking them to a prisoner of war camp where more of their either maybe family members that have, there's some reason why now that they've taken over the ship, they want to go there. And it could be anything, to free family members, to destroy important documents, or to just fuck up the bad guys. You know, we're in a ship.
I want to make Judo kill. He donates £3. Nat 20 for a red dragon.
Oh, okay. We got to put that in there now.
Got to put it in.
First Kickstarter stress goal. The reason the £3, that red dragon's going to fuck somebody up. There's really a fifth character sheet off to the side that we have.
Yeah.
To replace. That would be a funny idea, like if one of the PCs dies. Like one of the other persons raises his hands. Excuse me, I would like to fight. Here's the sheet. Number five is infiltration. So now you got the ship. How are you going to get into this base and keep up the ruse? So it says the party can pull the ship into harbor near the enemy base, which grants them easier initial access. But they must put up a strong ruse since they will be hiding in plain sight.
Uh-huh.
Or they can maybe land upriver or downriver of the base, then invade from the outside, granting them a safe place to plan, but a hard time sneaking in. And perhaps there are allies out there. Maybe there's a giant nearby who hates these red dragons that have been coming around. You know, this is kind of like where I think the module will truly start to branch off.
Right. Yeah.
And do one of these two things.
Sure.
And finally is sabotage, which is where they go in and fuck everything up.
Fuck
it up. And sabotage says, let's see, my bullet points. The party frees other prisoners of war in the camp. The party assassinates high-profile Skull Nation members. That'd be cool if they can, take over the Breath of Gorr and they get, like, a dossier of, like, these, like, lieutenants.
You go full, like, sniper elite.
And, Inglourious Basterds kind of thing.
Yeah.
Hugo Stiglitz, an orc.
The orc Nazis.
I speak. I can disguise myself as an orc. Rivendirchi. Once complete, the module ends with the PC's freedom, as well as the destruction of a high-profile Skull Nation base. So that's kind of what happens at the end. And then D, I put possible encounters for this particular base. The red dragon returns and defends the base. That'd be something neat. If like they let it go away, then they're attacked. If it goes on too long, they see the red dragon return.
Mm-hmm.
And she just starts, you know, so now you're just like the beginning of Skyrim. But
Or if they befriended the dragon, you know, maybe.
True.
Something else happens. There, you know?
True, they can do something with it.
Yeah.
However, the effect of that first encounter will bring back this kind of like we did this in point A, so point E down the road, all this kind of stuff. So dense.
So dank.
Part two, a squad of elite Skull warriors tracks the party down. So that could be a thing. Like they just this camp knows that there are infiltrators inside. So they got their like, you know, their, you know, SS guys going around figuring stuff out. Could even be like a demon because have Gorr, the evil orc god, on their side. Number three, a priest of Gorr in a temple in the center is sacrificing prisoners. So that's a thing. Maybe they're sacrificing prisoners and like, oh, we got to do something about that guy. Number four says crashing the Breath of Gorr into the dock for all kinds of mayhem. So that could be a thing they do.
Right.
How are we going to get in? Full speed ahead, into the dock.
Yep.
Just
crash this bad boy in.
Crash it in. Especially if they kill the dragon and put its like skull in the front, because it's going to be an old ship. It's going to look just badass. So it's kind of a badass.
Kind of a badass, this ship.
So that's kind of our breakdown, more or less, of the overall encounter one, encounter two, encounter three, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah. The general kind of events that we have planned for the module. I'm sure you guys got some questions. If you have any questions, feel free to shout them at us when it comes to the whole idea of the thing, or yes, the badass, if that comes into question.
I'll turn the AC on real quick.
Yeah, yeah. It's fucking hot over there. We do also have a couple of stat lines kind of figured out as well. A couple of ideas for PCs that you can see here. We're also, how do I join? Well, we plan on going to Kickstarter in June. So you
probably, money.
In a way, you've already kind of... in a way, you've kind of already joined, you know? We do plan on running some games of it, so who knows, maybe I'll do like a viewer game of, you know, playtesting the module out or something like that. Could be fun. What's up, Molly? Yeah, I think it will be a fun idea. Good for, you know, beginners and also for, you know, different levels of play as well. And we have some ideas for these villain guys as well. That I'm a big fan of. The Shatternaut is probably my favourite. Another ship in the Scout Nation's Navy lists one ship of war. The Shatternaut can be patrolling outside the prison camp while sent after the PCs should word lay mutiny reach back to the camp. The name of this thing just brings to mind this incredible orc warship with
the Shatternaut. Yeah.
And then the Shatternaut!
What do you want to call this ship, man?
Looks like it's going to break everything it comes across.
Yeah.
it's like the Executor from Star Wars. That's what like was in my mind when I was making it.
Yeah.
It's this big aircraft carrier.
Good variety for options of playstyles. Yeah, and hopefully it has some replayability as well, right? In terms of, you know, after you play for it once and you get a new player in, you could probably play for it again and take different options and go different ways of it and see what happens that way. And of course, we do have a little idea, supervillain D&D came out, right? It's happening, Haley, right? Next season, maybe. But yeah, we also had some plans for what happens afterwards. You know, like most campaigns that Wizards of Print, you have some ideas of where you could take it in an overall campaign, you know. Judo asks, will it both be digital hard copy for tabletop pen and paper play? We only plan currently on digital versions. We don't yet plan on doing any hardback, you know, print stuff like that. Mainly because it's really expensive for us to do, and we just really want to get something out.
It's uncharted territory for us at the moment, but we might look into it in the future.
Yeah, exactly. I'll break on literally the first obstacle. But yeah, that's the plan. Yeah, hopefully in the future, if this goes well, then we'll end up doing more and more projects and, you know, more, you know, exciting projects as well, bigger scope, bigger scale projects. But for now, we've kind of, you know, we didn't want to screw the pooch on the first one and be like, let's try for $10,000.
Yes!
And we're going to make D&D 6. Fate of Radioactive Bears for following a gentleman and a scholar. So we wanted to do something that was achievable, something that was but fun and exciting for us as well. And you guys know how much I enjoy like the early game stuff and, you know, teaching players games and, you know, getting new people involved. I really do love playing with newer players. So I think it's I just read that he's got a bad case of the crazy eyes. Yes, we're going to make D&D great again. Why did we make the ship out of glass and stickers?
Because we're orcs, that's why.
But yeah, that would be the general layout of the plan, I guess. Yeah, I'm trying to think what else might come up. How much are we looking to raise? Is again a question we don't have a exact answer for. We still are waiting for a couple of quotes back from artists and layout people, but it won't be one of those gigantic, we're looking for thousands of dollars worth of money, you know, probably more around like the $500 to $1,000 sort of range. So just everything, you know, we want it to be affordable for people when it comes out as well, you know, because we're not like, you know, you come when you want to play your first module, you don't really want to have to pay $50 for something, you know. And that's something, you know, price can be a big turnoff for chaotic triggered for like him or something. What's happening, Zoray? I have an adorable murder machine. Yeah, I can agree with that, Laura. But yeah, that's the idea for the start it now. Well, what's the reason for the delay, I guess? You know, we're 2 months away from June, basically, as we're heading into April. like we were mentioning, we want to come to Kickstarter with it basically done. We don't want to come to Kickstarter and be like, here's an idea. Do you want to give us some money for an idea that might never happen?
Here's my MS Paint trailer.
Yeah, here's my MS Paint trailer. Do you want to give me some money? We'd rather, you know, come with a finished product with the artwork already done, paid for out of, you know, my own pocket, and then Kickstarter to kind of make up that money that we've already invested into and time that we've invested as well, because, you know, we've been planning this for a couple, maybe 3 months, like Rem mentioned before, and now we've finally gotten a chance to, you know, really dig our teeth into it. And like I say, hopefully after this, you know, the plan would be to produce even more content for you guys, because I think it's something that is quite enjoyable to get to do. Something a little different from just, you know, streaming and stuff like that. So I'm excited for it. Rin, what do you think is the most, what are you most excited for when it comes to Breath of Gorr?
I think I'm really, I'm most excited for the fact that when, it's kind of one of the things that touches on in the beginning concept area. When you play D&D, especially for vets, you know, you kind of have, like, we see all this fan-created content, like custom classes, custom races. So it's like people want all this new stuff. That's cool. Okay, fine. You want new stuff. By pre-making these PCs, we are making characters that don't have to follow the typical race class rule.
Right.
If anything, we're not making PCs. It's like we're making monster manual entries. So these characters can do stuff that, you know, just that doesn't exist in a book. We can, you know, there's not any of that, okay, well, how do we set this aside to make HD progression make sense or progression bonuses make sense? And it's like, no, well, they're not a race in a class. It's you know, a custom character in a thing. They can have abilities that don't even exist yet.
We just
make them up.
We just make shit up.
We just made it all up. I think that'll get the vets in because... Yeah. These are characters you can only play like this. And maybe there's a way we can put in maybe an advancement, how they can get better or do more things, which is not necessary, might not be, because we'll play, you know, eight week sessions and never have characters level up.
So
a lot of folks, they want that crunchiness. They want that, maybe a talent trees would be like an easy
thing.
Yeah,
that's an interesting word.
Because I've always liked the idea of a talent tree better than the level up system anyways. It's like, okay, you've got this XP. Here's eight things you can do. Do you want the extra hit dice? Do you want this? Do you want that? And it costs 500 XP for this, 1,000 XP for that, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's our little way of doing it. At the same time, since we are kind of creating our own world to put this in, we can now, in kind of roleplay, have its own world, its own universe that does all of its events in. So the next published thing could take place in the same world. The Skull Nation War can be happening over here.
Yeah.
And if we expand on it long enough, hell, we might be able to do a world book
where it's an 80-page
campaign setting, all that kind of stuff.
Sounds exciting.
So that's my big kick.
Absolutely. We have one of these kind of PCs, an idea for PC out. Did we want to, you know, maybe do a bit of writing with chat and, you know, suggest some ideas for another player character that we could start creating?
Yeah, we can run through this PC right here, and then after that, let chat throw in their ideas for one of these prisoners on board this boat. See what they do. Maybe even do a tally at the end, and whichever one, gets it.
Yeah.
That works for me. They kind of created this module already from the get-go.
All right, so let's go through Boggs then, the big game hunter. So this is one of the player characters that we've already planned on. After we go through this one, you guys can throw in some ideas. We'll do a bit of writing together, and you guys can suggest some ideas for another player character that you could play in the module. The idea for Boggs came from needing a captured prisoner who could hide a weapon. Farming a dagger or sneaking in magic wand seemed too normal, so playing on Boggs' past seemed like the best idea. Boggs is a cunning combatant who has slain several big monsters, harvesting rare plants from them that he sells for gold. He has several burns and scars that he wears as trophies, including an eyeball from a beholder he slew. Sorry, including a gouged out eye. I missed a line there. Before the Scout Nation captured him, Boggs plugged his open eye socket with an eyeball from a beholder he slew. The beholder eye still holds its magic, and Boggs is biding his time until he can leash it on his captives. Until then, everyone just thinks he's got a bad case of the crazy eyes. So if you can imagine this character who's got a beholder eye coming out of his eye socket, that's Boggs. Mm-hmm. In the party, Boggs...
It still works.
Just, he's like a stormtrooper with his eye. Oh, man. The drums of war. Orc bard that focuses on inspirational drums. That's interesting. Okay. In the party, Boggs is best at fighting larger creatures. The greater their size category, the more bonus damage he deals, making him excellent at churning extra hit points off large foes. He can swing any weapon of skill, but his natural ability to finagle his way with a well-placed lie comes in handy as well. He's a bit crazy from taking one too many hits from giant beasts, but at least he knows he's teetering on insanity's edge. We might have to move it from beholder to other...
Yeah.
Of a creature because of the fucking SRD, but hey.
Although it's actually so perfect, though, we can use the beholder for it. Ah, I won't. He's got a dragon tooth shoved into space, I don't know.
Yeah. So that is Boggs. He has Forrest Whitaker eye. He's got a. That's terrible.
Oh man.
But you can see the stat block for Boggs, a big game hunter here. AC 12, 76 hit points, speed, 40 feet, and he's got bonus actions, corners, he's got extra attack and so on. Maybe spectator, yeah, spectator or Nofix.
Ooh,
depends
Nofix.
If they fall under SRDs. Because I know Nofix. That the both of them are basically beholders. Yeah. But yeah, he's also got, the slowing ray from the fact that he has a beholder eye coming out of his own stalk. But being an orc, Boggs has naturally solid solid score in both strength and constitution, allowing him to put up a strong fight in combat. Based on Boggs' character stats, he brings four elements to the party. One, the larger the creature, the more damage he deals. Two, the more wounded he is, the harder he is to hit. Missing Boggs and attack cause him to fight back. And three, his beholder eye can debuff opponents, allowing him to kite them with his 40-foot movement speed. And four, his insight skill helps him deal with people, while his survival skill helps him dissect and harvest animal plants. So all of this, again, is, basically ideas that we have, so none of it is fully fleshed out. But you get the idea for Boggs. So I'm going to go over here and just onto this Google document that we have currently, and just throw in some other ideas for other player characters' ideas. And we can work on this with you guys for a bit here.
The Nofix are not in the SRD either.
Ah.
Damn.
God diddly darn. So, what ideas for other player characters do you guys have? We had one from Mo, which was regarding an orc drummer. They don't have to be orcs, right, Rem?
No, they don't have to be. Yeah. I just kind of kept with the orcs in general, just to, figure it out. And we probably don't want, every single one to be an orc as well, just kind of like you said.
Right.
Maybe have, orcs are the new human in this
adventure.
That's kind of my theme.
Okay. So we've got an orc drummer. That sounds quite interesting. Almost like a bard, maybe. Orc bard that focuses on inspirational drums,
What if he has a hag eye?
Ooh,
hags have those eyes. Yeah, there you go. He's got like a witch's eye.
Yeah, yeah.
That's why he's crazy.
Because he's got a witch in him.
He's like, maybe she's still alive a little bit.
A little bit in the eye, yeah. Maybe a bit of her personality comes through every now and again.
Yeah.
I like the idea of an orc huntress as well. One where you can, more of like a rangery type of of character. And good to have. Fuckers, do you want to just stick to normal D&D rules?
Just give us a concept and we'll move the mechanics.
Basically. Yeah, yeah. Tweet incoming, oh dear. Boggs the big game. with a picture of Whitaker, thank you. poor guy.
Take care of our artwork. What's that?
Oh, it's an excellent meme.
Oh, okay.
Of the eye. I like the idea of a drummer, and you could have abilities that inspire buff slash debuff the other PCs, or just other combatants, I guess would be a better term.
Mm-hmm.
You've got an Orc Huntress, Ranger, damage dealer, I guess, a bit of a glass cannon almost. Mm-hmm.
That's like the one of the ideas I had. We could mention that was the critical person.
Yes.
Who, like, every time she scores a crit, her crit threshold increases, so it goes from nat 20 to nat 19, 20, nat 18, 20, until she takes a short rest, then it goes back to normal.
Yeah,
that could
be
a thing that. Although it doesn't have to be the same character.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. I love the idea of a kobold goblin crazy inventor.
Yeah.
Someone who's like...
Oh, that'd be cool, because that finagles things together, like, I need to escape.
Yeah, yeah, you can make stuff, maybe, yeah. A wildling human druid raised by beasts. Okay, cool. Human druid raised by beasts. I guess a kobold inventor could be quite a cool idea for like that scientist type of, or like alchemist type character, you know? Alright, we've got a wood elf cleric from Jamie. Don't forget the obligatory Aarakocran barbarian.
She can be a parrot.
Parrot. Or maybe one of them is a pirate and he's got a parrot.
Yeah, or a halfling on his shoulder.
Pirate with a parrot slash halfling on shoulder.
I've always thought it'd be a great idea for like a pirate adventure where there's like this notorious captain. But the captain himself isn't the actual like mastermind. It's the parrot on his shoulder. It's like an int, like 24 parrot. And since parrots live to like 120 years old anyways, that's why this pirate has been so deadly. It's just this parrot hops on different parrot's shoulder and, okay, listen, you're the new captain. You're the new Dread Pirate Roberts.
I'm gonna tell you
what to do.
I love that term, like shoulder halfling.
Shoulder halfling.
Yes. Maybe a half orc, like explore their orc side. Yeah, okay, that's an interesting idea as well. Just not full orc. Psionic parrot.
What was that? There was that West Marches game where there were like six magic, wild magic rolls donations for like a bird at a talent show. Like what was?
Yes, it was. I forgot his name. Yes, I remember the bird though. It was like it was.
Yeah.
It's on the tip of my tongue. I can hear him saying it. I just can't say it.
Yeah. It's like it turned all like iron into liquid.
Chauncey.
Or mercury.
Chauncey,
yeah. Everyone just like
tree fell the same. Oh my god. A mascot. Oh, that was some old school.
Tree fell. We're going to make her our librarian.
Yeah. Official encounter roleplay librarian. Now, the mascot is a sort of support dragon type of fighter. This unknown being is in a costume of some kind of beast. Ooh. That's cool. I like the idea of a lizard man as well.
Yeah.
It's delusional and thinks it's a pet parrot, but it's actually just a Kenku rogue. It's just been stealing all these ideas. I love that. And an auric fighter or barbarian who thinks they are the rogue who beats the shit out of people under the name of pickpocketing. I'm a rogue! All right.
Keeps his hands up and just goes, shh, but like, lays the club up.
Who believes he is a rogue? Yeah. Okay, fantastic. We've got some great ideas in so far. I like the idea of having like a bit of a balance in the party as well, so you don't just have all orc, all orc barbarians or whatever. You know, you've got the kind of wood elf healer type, or the just the crazy one. an angry furry. Mine got skipped. Oh, there's chat going by. Let me see. A half orc kobold half robot. So oh, like God. A like a mech type warp character. Forge. Yeah, like
what
a
if it's
forge,
like a power,
though?
The half orc kobold is in a machine.
Oh, it's like they're piloting it, like a mech almost.
It's like maybe the machine is locked up in like where all the captive prisoners' weapons are. And so it starts off as just this like weeny little kobold once he gets his machines.
It's like
Iron Man.
Weeny kobold slash goblin, I guess. who has a like a mech suit almost. So it's a bit like those, they'd be a bit like the goblins from like World of Warcraft, like Tinker and
Tinker, you know,
make stuff and yeah, that kind of goblin. A friendly pet mimic.
Oh, yes. The treasure chest is a mimic.
The whole ship is a mimic.
Yes!
No one can see you if they're all dead. That's true. I had a friend play an Undyne in a Pathfinder game. She was a pirate. When asked what an Undyne is, she'd say, I fancy way of saying my father shagged a fish. It does not sound good. Should make them all psychologically damaged, like an escaping team of mental patients. So they're kind of escaping the crazy prison.
My father shagged a fish. I swore she was a mermaid. I thought she was a mermaid. It was just a bass.
It was straight up bass.
Straight up bass. I was tapping that bass.
Oh man, it's Chuck Bass. Mighty Morphin Kobold Fighters, 5 kobolds that form the Mega Borg. That sounds like an awesome like enemy.
Oh yeah, like 5 like kung fu kobolds.
Yeah, but... yeah, kung fu kobolds. Yeah, what about enemies? Human water elemental. Oh, okay, didn't know what that was.
Double mermaid.
Yeah, I love the idea of kung fu kobolds. Being like an enemy that could fight against, Yuan-Ti like... Snake Charmer. Ooh. I like Liu Yuan-Ti.
Oh, that's Wizards copyright.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, Sagin Wizard, a jelly for the host. He's a bad wizard though, because his spellbook constantly gets destroyed in the water. Shit!
Damn!
You're like,
I'm gonna have to put this in a plastic bag.
Put it in a Ziploc bag. He has to put it in a Ziploc every time he goes on. He's like, ha! I'm just gonna escape to my underwater realm. Shit!
Yeah! Oh, damn! I'm never getting out.
A goblin piloting a stone golem. That's a bit like the kobold is like the mech suit. That could be another way of doing that, I guess. Dude, that was a fish. Dude, you know you just fucked a salmon, right? High elf priest. So that's kind of like the wood elf cleric, yeah, like the slash priest. What's up, Pave Loden? 5 hours of trying to back on it turn out to be guys. Oh my god, the catfish. Could someone be like a lycanthropic werepanda so they could actually be a kung fu panda? We're getting into the realms of like ultimate snowflake now.
Like Mr. Pandarian.
Yeah. All right. What about enemy creatures that they could end up fighting, guys? We've got some.
Like the captain.
Yeah, yeah. The captain of the ship. You know, if there's this orc war vessel, you could. Is he like an orc himself? Is he like a bugbear or something along those lines?
Does he have the first mate or like the cook? I was like, they did like have to fight the cook, and he's this big dude with an apron and a cleaver, you know. Just,
oh no, I love it.
That's always a fun like mini boss on the ship.
Starbucks. What we're doing, Sarcastry, we're taking a look at this new module that we're taking to Kickstarter, and you guys are going to help us write it. And currently we're thinking of enemy ideas. They're on a orc warship. Oops, fuck me. Baby attacks.
It's a boat full of babies. It's the just, legitimate boss baby. Oh.
That would be terrifying. If this is a horror campaign, maybe so. Just your
babies.
They're the creepy baby dolls. An orc crusader, yeah. I like. What about a wizard who cannot learn offensive spells, but rather has to use creative methods of fighting, perhaps a toned down cantrip version of a catapult spell being its only offensive spell as a PC? I like that idea.
Okay.
Like a wizard who can't...
Like a telepath wizard kind of thing. And the thing is, we can create our own spells. Because we want everything to be in this module. But you don't need the PHB or your monster manual, unless to look up, you know, actual rules.
Yeah. What was it? There was a book I used... What book is it where there's a wizard that can only cast, like, the spell cheese, and anything he touches turns into cheese? There's a book I read when I was younger. It was so good. Oh, man.
Turn the button, Swiss cheese, so we'll see. We have to get out, but to eat our way out.
I turn it into cheese. Lizard man, more like snake. Okay, so you got like a lizard folk type creature. Tritons.
We can make our own snakes.
We can make our own snakes.
Make our own snakes.
Triton raiders. deranged baby dragon who stole all the town's silverware and is now sitting on a huge pile of spoons and forks. some kind of dragon-like creature, I guess.
Sid is like, damn it, well, we finally got all these plates, but we don't have anything to eat.
No, we don't have any cutlery! The humanity!
We need all the cutlery, but we have all these plates.
Oh, man. I like the idea of some kind of lizardy type creature, though, whether it's a dragon, whether it's like a lizard man. Because it might not necessarily just be like a big orc, right? Because I think the boring thing to say would be like, he's the biggest orc ever!
Yeah.
Something interesting to him.
Or let's see, the Quaddles aren't really bad. We can maybe make a problem, cool little, like maybe an orc that's been like enchanted, or maybe like, maybe what's something that Gorr can do? What could be, we can build up on the character, God of Feats Gorr. Like maybe like if he blesses somebody, they become like this deep demonic like fiend subtype, and that can be where our snake theme comes in.
Yeah.
Snakes are all about eating big giant things like that. The sound of the snake. The snake.
Yeah. Shalom, what's up? How's it going? I was just talking at the beginning of the stream here. Thank you so much for this dice bag. It's fucking awesome. Thank you so much. Hopefully, I think the tweet has just gone out just a second ago, but fucking awesome. Love you so much, Shalom. Appreciate that. And Sydney says a huge thank you as well for her makeup thing as well. I don't know what it is, but it was makeup. A silver dragonborn who's legitimately believes he's the son of Bahamut. Ooh. I was gonna say as well, what about like the Breath of Gorr itself having like lair actions that he can use, you know, like something that, you know,
like grab the sails or like even a cannon, like do we want to use gunpowder in this world?
I think so.
Okay. Yes. Sure.
The Breath of Gorr you know, could have has lair actions. That the boss.
And then when the party takes over, now they have access to
the now and they have access to the lair actions as well, like the cannons and stuff like that. Thanks so much, Shalom. They worship an enormous ancient ooze as a god and they make sacrifices.
That could be like Gorr. That's like, it's like he's all about eating the stomach acid.
Right.
That can be his I guess some of the gods in Greek, they have like monsters that are theirs. Like he's like the patron god of oozes and all this kind of stuff. It has to do with like eating. So you know, oozes.
Yeah. And maybe like the bowels. The bowels of the ship are, you know, like oozy stuff where like if you're sent down to the brig.
The brig has like the ooze room.
The ooze room. Yeah. I kind of want to remember the idea of some kind of ancient ooze now. Yeah. You know, the orcs worship Gorr as their god. An ogre chef. That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
But I teamed up for a character, a wizard that uses paintings or brings paintings to life. Oh, almost like Layers of Fear, but in a good way. It's interesting, but it might not be any paintings on board the ship. Maybe some orc artistry around. I don't know.
Maybe it's got like tattoos, and the different tattoos are different things that it can do.
Yeah, that's a cool idea. Like a tattoo mage is something that we've looked at. Yeah. Ooze domain cleric.
Ooze domain cleric.
A goblin who believes he is an orc, so he acts all big and uses a great axe. I kind of like that idea for a character. Goblin who believes he's an orc.
I'm just an orc.
The blood of orc could be blood golems that serve as the ship's security.
Gorr, he gives them like, this is my blood. Rawr, it's this kind of thing. And there's like one of those on the ship. Just as that's like the ship's like quartermaster security thing. It's unintelligent, but like it takes orders from the ship.
I like that. Yeah. Blood golems are the blood, you know, the chosen blood of Gorr or something like that.
We can work some of this like blood magic into that. It says on the PDF there's that one character. Let me scroll down. Let me read this to you guys in chat. Chosen, this was like an idea I put in. We can work these suggestions into this guy.
Yeah.
The chosen of Hosh, the orc god of curses, Hosh has now declared war on Gorr. As such, Hosh has bestowed gifts on certain followers, granting them shamanistic powers. One such gifted individual is a PC on board the Breath of Gorr. The PC is scheduled to be sacrificed, but as time goes on, more powers manifest. The DM doles out new spells or abilities to the PC as different tasks go on. Possible ways the PC manifests powers is by sacrificing HP for instead of spending spell slots. So like instead of a third level spell slot, they have to roll 3d8 or whatever, lose that much HP, and they can cast the spell.
And that can
work with some of these ideas they're throwing in, like the Blood Mages, stuff like that.
Yeah, where's Bloodbender when we need him? How about flying ships and boats who have a magic machine or simply imprisoned flying beings forced to lift it? Ooh, that's an interesting idea. I love this idea of the blood going between it.
What if the Shadow Knot is built on the back of a giant ancient red dragon?
Oh, shit, yeah.
There we go. The Shadow Knot is on a red dragon. That's like old and decrepit, but being controlled, sort of like that.
Yeah.
So that flying ship, that's how they got their flying ship, is there's... And they have to figure out a way to either disable it or...
So the Shatternaut can fly.
Yeah.
All right, okay. All right, so guys in chat, we're going to move on to thinking about some ideas about this other ship, the Shatternaut. So it's like an orc-controlled vessel, but it's built on the back of an ancient red dragon, so it can fly. Mm-hmm. And that's how they get around so easy, because they can fly on it. Do you guys throw out some ideas about this Shatternaut, this vessel, about the orcs on it, any like abilities that they have or abilities that the ship has? I mean, I think it would be kind of awesome that it could breathe fire, right?
Yeah. Or if this is the camp, like, you know, like they don't know that the Shatternaut is built on the back of this red dragon, and it's maybe been like sleeping there for a while.
Ah.
Or there's kind of place, like, instead of like, we're taking them to the Shatternaut, and that's what they hear. Oh, they're taking us to the big,
right,
to the big ship. And they then, like, as they're fighting on top of the ship, it suddenly like lifts up out of the ground. It's like, what the fuck? it's on top of a red dragon.
Yeah.
They're fighting in the air, and like they can like either kill the red dragon somehow, because it's maybe can play in the fact that it's old and not maneuverable, so it can maybe reach around and throw some fire back.
Okay, so like, yeah, maybe like an old dragon. So maybe they can't like, so it can't fly so much.
Maybe it can, but not like crawling up around,
right,
like acrobatically fly. That way, it kind of keeps the PCs from, like, okay, well, I gotta hold on before we fall off the edge, as it does like a loopy loop.
Oh yeah, I like this idea. The ship captain is a chosen priest of Grumsh.
Okay.
Or another god.
Or Gorr.
Yeah, maybe Gorr. Yeah, maybe they work together. You know, yeah. Ancient red dragon bleeds boiling blood, so hazardous environment.
Ooh, yeah. Like you kill it and fire comes out.
Yeah.
And then like one PC can take advantage of it, like just taking the sword and across and letting all this.
Yeah. So why exactly is a dragon working for the orcs instead of just killing them? I don't know.
No, man.
You tell me.
You tell me, Crafty Geek. I can ask questions too.
What's up, Zach? Just going. My man. When killed, the dragon, maybe...
Or to kind of build off on Crafty Geek said, because, you know, the Spires of Kunrakus, they're allied with the orcs. So why would one kind of be turned into a slave? Maybe it's not a red dragon, but like a different kind of color dragon, like a green or a black dragon.
Yeah.
And they've beaten it. They got stuff wired into its head where they can control it. And that could be a thing. If you can free the dragon from their influence. Then they turn the Shatternaut.
I kind of like the idea of a black dragon, actually, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. C433, the following, a gentleman and a scholar. Okay, yeah, I like that idea.
Destroy the Shatternaut, let's say now the Shatternaut and the camp are different entities. So now that they've, like, freed the Shatternaut, it's like, hey, you wanna, we're trying to take them out. You wanna take them out with us?
And it's... Yeah. Okay, so, so maybe... Yeah, maybe the dragon is captured, you know, imprisoned by the orcs somehow, you know, because he's old, due to his old age. And so the PCs could choose to free him or kill him. Either way, there's probably, you know, if you kill it, you probably get a bit more loot, but if you free it, you've got an ally in a later, you know, encounter, and maybe it's the right thing to do. Spikes on dragon's back, also being a hazard environment. Yeah, exactly, yeah. The orcs...
Oh, yeah, that'd be awesome.
Oh, I like the idea. Ship is made up of big metal slabs that move randomly and change shape as the pilot wishes. kind of cool, like a shifting environment sort of deal. It could be difficult to do if we wanted to map stuff, though. But that's an interesting idea.
Yeah, like if the Breath of the Gore itself could be a bit simplistic, especially at the beginning. But that's like the small dungeon that they have to go through.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then when they get to like the Shatter Knot and the camp itself, that could be, that's where we get like all the freaky nonsense.
It's like in Oblivion, when you play through the sewer level. That's a bit on the Breath of Gore. And then you go into the open world, and then all this shit becomes possible.
Fallout 3 with the vault.
The vault, yeah. The orcs perhaps did a ritual infusing their blood of Latla dragons, giving them special powers, or maybe only the captain does that as a sign of leadership. I like that idea.
Ooh, also, black dragon, maybe acid blood, we're still with this like gore theme of, devouring.
Yeah.
So maybe that's why they can like dominate black dragons, but they forge alliance with the red dragons, but they can have the power to dominate a black dragon.
Yeah.
Black dragons don't like that.
I love the idea that they dip their cannonballs in dragon blood. Like, how cool is that? Like this explosive dragon blood, and they kind of like dip it in and then put it into the cannon and fire it off. I definitely like the idea that we have, gunpowder and, a bit kind of...
Well, they use like magic stuff. It's like if it's all the stuff built in the back of this dragon, spike dragon, because they live in swamps, they can kind of swim or fly when they need to.
Yeah.
It's like they have like part of its back, like some scales pulled back to like just where they just dig in and scrape out blood and... Man, this black dragon's gonna be pissed if they can get free.
Oh, man. and maybe because they're dipping it in this blood, they are, continuing to like torture it, so they're like extracting blood from it, maybe. It's almost like an experiment at the same time. The ship have two cannons that shoot ice and two cannons that shoot fire, or maybe some kind of like acid as well, rather than ice and fire, maybe like acid and necrotic like energy.
Kind of like a feeding tube kind of thing, or it's like hooked into the black dragon's mouth that they use to like siphon out, the acid from it.
Yeah,
put
yeah.
in like a little like fire hose thing so they can.
Ooh, I feel so bad for this dragon. Yeah,
I know this dragon's gonna be pissed.
Yeah, the cannons, shoot acidic and necrotic, energy, I suppose, or they're dipped in that energy. I love that idea, Inseray. The orcs on the ship have scarred themselves to gain Gorr's favor. Each of them wounded the first, uses their blood to gain advantage on their future attacks. So maybe, that's an interesting idea. Like they hurt themselves, like sacrifice to Gorr, but
like
then they... They kind of flagellate themselves. But when they do that, they get a advantage on an attack or, an extra damage. That's a cool idea for a mechanic. I guess we could call these Shatter Noughts. As the orcs, something like that. I don't know.
It'll work.
For now, Shadow Noughts can wound.
I bet if you approach like Flip or the artist that we use, and hey, we want you to draw an ancient black dragon with a ship built into its back.
Yeah, he's gonna fucking love this stuff, I can tell you. And that's nothing we can do as well is one of our artists, Flip, who's done all the artwork for all of the overlays and all of the channel artwork that you see. He's gonna be the artist that we're working with. He absolutely loves getting to do D&D stuff, so he's a big D&D fan, big Critical Role fan as well. Shadnauts can wound themselves and, gain bonuses to, attack / damage, something along those lines. Gorr is so ancient, has developed telepathic abilities. That's what keeps the dragon enslaved.
He's got like a priest. He's like maybe Gore's channeling through a priest on board, and that priest is like, what can we call these priests that take over dragons?
Dolakim. Da 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 da. I don't know, like dragon. Dragon benders. That sounds terrible.
What's that class that you were reviewing last
Sunday? Yeah, dragon tamers. That's the one. We need some dragon tamers.
Or they can be called shatter knots.
Yeah, that maybe that's what,
like shatter.
Or shatter knights. Yeah, so I don't know.
Shatter knights.
Yeah.
Shatterbrain. It sounds like a really southern person saying shatterbrain.
What's that, Steve Isaac guy, mate? We're having a good time here, my friend. Psionics, okay, let me read through some of this stuff that you guys have written down. Sarcastic idea. One of the crew, quartermaster or something, resents the captain for some reason. Players could have a chance to form an uneasy alliance with him or any mutineers.
I like that.
Okay, yeah. So, NPC on board who could be used as
Shatter
an
butts.
Shatter butts.
Raise the cannon and they lift up the black dragon's tail.
Time to shatter this butt. They grow orcs inside a dragon like an earth, and they come out as blorks. It's kind of an interesting idea that you could use that body as like a host almost. Ooh. Sorry for all that, but it would be worth saying that the cannons are modified full of blood-covered ammunition, because it sounds like it'll just explode. Yeah, I mean, yeah, this, you know, magic science, who knows. Red dragon spawn, red fire bleachers are living flamethrowers. I really like the idea of having these kind of, like Ren was saying, these kind of like hoses that are living flamethrowers on board the ship. The more and more we're talking about, like, the worse it's going to be for the player characters, and you guys are going to be the ones playing this, you realize.
What if a PC is a black half-dragon? And like, when they see this shit going down. Like, that could be, like, another throwing things out.
I like the idea as well for the player characters. More than just having, like, four of them, you could have, like, six or seven, and you choose out of those. So each time, you know, or maybe eight of them, so you could play for it twice, and everyone could have a different character.
Those can be stretch goals.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Or the Kickstarter. Like, if we reach this, then another PC.
Yeah, yeah.
So if we got, 12 PCs, that'd be... Because that's how, Games Workshop is doing a lot of their box games.
Oh, really?
Is you can use, like... It's like, if you have the model... That's like, here's the game that comes with four models, but if you have these other models, we got, like, rules for them. So you essentially have, like, a 40-person roster to run through this with.
Yeah, I love that idea. Yeah. Every last one of them. Guys, I'm so unique.
Well, put them into the Drist machine.
Into the Drist.
We need more Drist.
Man, Sam, the Dristometer is over 10,000.
It'd be great if you're a PC and just mowing down Drists.
That would feel fucking fantastic, to be fair. You get all these fire hoses and you just aim it at the Drist machine.
It's called the Dritzkrieg. We need more Dritz. Bring in the Dritzkrieg.
Oh man. Oh, Hitler missed a trick, you know.
He
missed a trick.
He should have waited about 80 years.
Yeah. Dragon minders, those who control a dragon. Oh, I like that idea. Yeah. Yeah, dragon minders.
And like the leader of the Spirits of Kunrak is the big bad dragon. He's actually being controlled. So they're not allied out of mutual gain. They're really And if the PCs can find that out by like finding whatever they can, that's like a potential future thing. Hey, any of the enemies, but he's gonna fuck him up.
What's up, Spartans? How's it going, man? Okay, the front of the ship is a dragon's maw. Saxus just subscribed. How many months is that, Saxus? Fuck me. The stream. Wait, 8 months! Holy moly, a gentleman and a scholar. Raise some drinks in chat to Saxus, everybody.
He's expecting.
He is expecting. 1 month, baby. Okay, I love the idea that the front of the ship is a like the maw of the dragon itself. So that's what they can like batter into things with. And how about this as well? It's called the Shatternaut for a reason, right? Because they just ram it into shit, you know? And this, what if this dragon's maw, because it's been rammed into so much shit, is like really like broken up and almost like destroyed and you know really gruesome,
with like bronze and like gold and like stuff that's built over it, almost like to like replace
to like protect
stuff
yeah
off.
Yeah, oh man, I feel really bad.
It's gonna have so much fun.
Yeah. Yeah. The front of the Shatternaut is the maw of the black dragon. I feel like we might need a name for this black dragon as well.
See, because I know if I can draw a succubus, Cliff can draw a dragon boat.
Yeah. You guys, give us some dragon names, yo.
Yeah,
I'm going to read through all this stuff in a minute, don't you worry. Front of Shadnought is more of the black dragon, which has been, you know, crippled and damaged over time as it has been used as a ram. I like the idea that they have... the orcs have embossed it almost with bronze, like you're saying there. to protect it. But in reality, that's going to be really fucking painful to get, like, molten bronze poured onto your fucking face. That would be really fucking painful.
I know, bronze dragon!
Steve-O, we are taking a D&D module to Kickstarter. You guys are helping us write it. It's coming in June. Let me scroll up here. There's a lot of stuff we missed. I would add a primitive race called Norkers being imprisoned on a ship to breed and be fed to the dragon to keep it alive. They aren't friendly. But if the PC's released, they might divert attention from the PC's actions. So, like, how do they feed a dragon? So maybe maybe they get slaves. Maybe there's this new race. Lab Chimps, some slaves of their blood replaced by the blood of the dragon, horribly scarring them, but turning them to miners' crew that are linked to the dragon. That's cool. So not all of the crew are necessarily just orcs, but you've got these... because we had this idea that it was almost like a war going on, right, Rem? So maybe they're like prisoners of war?
Yeah, like then there could be different clans, different nations that are being fixed with them.
Yeah, yeah. Have been captured and had their blood replaced with that of the dragons, sending them, you know, insane, but turning them into like mindless automatons almost.
It's like, chat, there are not nearly enough apostrophes in your dragon name suggestions. You can have like 3 apostrophes.
Very. I don't know what they're armed with yet. Let's see here. How about Shatnauts, which are dragon blood infused orcs, use chained maces in the way they hurt themselves to flay their backs? That is really cool. Yeah, they kind of like whip themselves whilst they attack. Yeah. Armed with chained maces to flagellate themselves with. Yeah, okay, let's go through some names. Nevranth, Dragon McDragonface, Dargon.
Oh, God.
Chartorvasal, Yetrinix the Broken.
Ooh, I like Yetrinix.
Nindot, Lord of Fire, Bob. Bob the Dragon.
Bob.
They have a Kobo translator that translates Delzra, the Voiceless. I like all of these names.
Ooh, the Voiceless.
The Voiceless sounds good because it's like, yeah, I like that epithet, the Voiceless.
Like the Voiceless Crier.
Ooh, yeah. Ooh. Apostrophe.
Apostrophe. Yeah, apostrophe.
the Voiceless Crier, something like that?
Yeah. Voiceless Weeper, the Voiceless Dirge.
Dirge. Yeah, I like that, yeah. Okay, not Druge. So, which one do we like out of those? We've got Delzra.
It's between Delzra and Yetrinix. Yetrinix has just enough weird Y's and X's to
Yetrinix,
make it.
Yeah. Yetrinix might be, yeah, Yetrinix. Nevranth. Nevranth's quite good as well.
Yeah.
Okay,
let's steal names out of chat, like actual chat. Okay, chat wants to be a dragon.
Basilini. He wants to be a dragon, guys. Guys want to be a dragon?
That's what I would do when I might come up with NPCs in my West Marches game. I just, like, whoever said the next thing.
What about...
Shonagoth.
It's Shonagoth, the Voiceless Dirt. Kidding. What about Xanath? Xanath.
Xanax. They gotta keep her asleep somehow.
Alright, yeah, what do we poll it? It's a good idea.
Let's poll the dragon. Let's poll the dragon.
Alright, so let's go to strawpoll.me. Dragon name. Which ones do we want to put in this one, room? Yetrinix. Something like that. Nevranth. Something like that.
Yes.
Zinix. I like that one, actually. Nick, there we go. Raif.
Raif.
Tells no lies. Stromata. Tomata.
I say Stromato.
I just did Ferrisval. Ferrisval. Alright, we'll put these. Ferrisval. Yetronix, Nevranth. Alright, Ferrisval. Any others do we want to put in here?
Mo Al Kasemi.
No Sea Man.
Vesuvius. I like Vesuvius.
It's like Vesuvius, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll put Nasoem. Alright, I'll do those lot. Alright, you guys vote on them. Oops, that's not what I wanted to do. There we go. Alright, you vote on that. You let me know what you're thinking. Okay, so we've got a dragon name. I love currently how that's shaping up for the Shatternaut. It sounds like a fucking awesome ship. Yeah, fuck me. Okay.
Police.
Oh, that scares me every fucking time.
It scares. Last night I was like laying down to go to bed and I forgot to put the phone on vibrate. And I'm starting to doze off and I just hear, police. Ah!
Okay, so we got the Chateau. I feel like that's pretty well laid out in terms of what we want that to be. But I was thinking one thing, though. Who is the captain of the Chateau? And I was thinking, if someone...
it's going to be someone beastly. This is going to be like a...
Yeah. And I was almost thinking, like, not if we were going to have the ship of the Breath of Gorr to be this titanic, you know, ancient ooze, maybe we just wanted someone who was like really clever but really cruel for the Chateau, because they've managed to you know, create this like cannon stuff. They managed to like drip feed acid out of the dragon and torture it. Someone's like super
smart.
Up. Yeah,
like
yeah.
A wizard, like an old like wizard, or even a lich, some kind of like demi lich.
Ooh,
like a all kinds of stuff.
Yeah. Okay. Can a tail be a catapult? That's fucking awesome. Yeah, who do we want?
I was thinking maybe like a vampire kind of thing. Like the captain stays in the captain's deck the whole time.
Yeah, and that's he comes why. Out, yeah, that's interesting. Okay, so what about you guys in chat? What ideas do you want for the captain of the Chateau? Like a mind flayer type creature as well. Obviously, God, I think we can do that. But why is it called Voiceless? The idea being that it's like captured and imprisoned by these orcs, and it's it's not allowed to speak and. Basically a prisoner. Captain should be a woman, like a little bit dominatrixy. Okay. If there's a
dominatrix. See, Mindflayer is getting into, I think, some IP.
Some IP issues.
Or you guys can make up your own.
You can make up your own monster.
Kind of
I mean.
Ancient monster.
Yeah. We are not.
Or even like a red dragonborn, like a smaller red dragon that likes the idea of
capturing other dragons. Yeah. Yeah. Maybe it's got like an inferiority complex because it's not actually a dragon. Yeah. The captain is the ship. Ooh, there must always be a captain. I use a half golem lich type creature rather than just magic. He uses artifice. Interesting. A half golem lich. Make him a midget.
Midget, yes.
Ah, the most feared.
It's Winky Slipfoot.
Oh boy!
I didn't think you would find me in here. Oh.
Risking it for the biscuit. All right, so we've got Vampire, Mind Flayer, Lich, Red Dragonborn, Half Golem, Lich. I think we'll cross out Mind Flayer because we'll run into IP. But Vampire or Lich to me sounds fucking awesome. Because you know. The Lich has either been wanting to extend his own life by infusing his own blood with dragon's blood, maybe. Or the other way to do it with the vampire is that the vampire is feeding off the dragon's blood. It's my blissful idea. Core Chateau, the creator of the ship and the one that captured the dragon, with her Chateau's being her disciples and teaching them the way of dreadnoughting. Ooh. Thank you for the donation, my friend, of course. That sounds like an interesting idea. I like the idea that she's female, certainly. I like that idea. So we know she's female, core Chateau. So maybe that's why they call it the Chateau, or maybe she's taken the last name of the ship, perhaps.
Her ship riding is like this ancient kind of like she like the ultimate taxidermist.
What if she's a if we know she's female, core Chateau could be her name, and she's a vampire, so we could go with all three of those, kind of bundling her into one.
Yeah.
And she, female.
So the ship is the Flaxery. Ooh, that's
interesting. Ooh, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah. So then do we save the Black Dragon and therefore keep the vampire alive so she can like harass them later? Or do we just end it now? Like when you kill, do we kill Draco to kill Einan? You know?
Yeah. But I mean, like, just because it's a vampire doesn't mean it can't have some kind of phylactery, you know? It could be.
Yeah.
Or we could go with Lich. I mean, but I do like the idea that the blood feeds off the blood of the dragon.
Yeah, and it gives her, like, some cool powers.
Yeah. Granting her extraordinary. I cannot spell.
So is she a vampirate?
Oh. Mm. Oh, vampires. We just went there without even meaning to. Extraordinary powers. Fuck yeah. We have just done vampires. That was a cool book when I was a kid, though. Or a cool
series. Yeah, I remember seeing it at the store and I was like, vampires? I just gotta get this just to put on the shelf.
Oh man, vampire can become a lich, so perhaps the next step she's working towards. Okay, working towards becoming a lich, total lich.
So if the PCs take out all these guys, they're putting a huge slam into the Skull Nation, because it's like, guys, what did we lose in the last attack? Well, we lost our vampire lich, we lost our Shatternut ship, we lost some slaves. Bam, fuck, just pull back and...
I've read those books. Yeah, me too. They were quite fun, I seem to remember. The poll is tied between Yetronix and Ferrisval, so if you haven't voted yet, vote on one of those two, and we'll see what we can get going.
Vote now.
Vote now, or forever. Hold your peace.
You might want to put a countdown on that. Once it hits.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Once it hits zero, boom.
Boom. Vampire would be a powerful spellcaster. Perhaps she has a dagger or something infused with her blood she can use to enslave humans. Ooh. Maybe that's how she's been enslaving the orcs as well.
Oh, yeah.
Prisoners of war have been captured by Kor. And had their blood replaced out. The dragon sent him the same, but turning into the Minus Automatons. Maybe she does this, you know, with a magical item, so we could throw in a magic item for loot-wise. With her magical dagger of, like, sacrifice or something, you know? That's something else you could, you know, we could look at doing for the Kickstarter as well, you know, new items that get added into the game for loot and random tables, stuff like that. It'd be pretty fun.
I'm just imagining if we could go to, like, you know, a hard copy version of this game, how we could have, like, a deck of cards that's your magic items, you know, I'd love, like, incorporate cards and unfoldable maps, but that's a debt down the road.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be like a $20 buy-in, probably.
I don't think a vampire would be really living on a ship with orcs. Ain't seeing it. I mean, a vampire doesn't mean you have to be human. You could be an orc vampire.
True.
Yeah.
True. With that.
Yeah. Orc vampire. I like that.
Or an orc lich, if we want to go that route.
Or an orc lich, yeah. Or orc vampire becoming lich. I don't know. One of those options. The captain could be a hench beast. Basically, keeps the crew in line through fear and brute strength. But it's actually this advisor who's pulling the strings behind the scenes. Could be this femme vamp character, especially the mastermind behind it all, who has to deal with the captain. That's interesting. So we kind of present to them this big, big bad, but actually, you know, behind the scenes is actually more going on. That could be interesting. It might.
That's where the midget is. He's pulling off the strings.
It's a cool idea. The only thing I'm considering is that if they are immediately going to be in combat with Le Chastinol, which it sounds like it's going to be quite possibly, then they might not have time to, like, discover that. You know, Stonky's fun to spoilers. Her tusk could be extremely sharp and act as vampire. That's cool. Fucking awesome.
She's got, like, these like upward curling, like, those are her fangs. Oh, that's a cool
I love that idea. Yeah,
and instead of transforming into a bat, she transforms into a snake.
Why isn't Mo on a design team? I mean, of course, upward curling tusks are what she uses to drain the blood of her victims. Yeah, I love that idea. She can, like, hold them up on her tusks as well, kind of like in a rutting sort of motion. How about giant maggots and giant bloatflies that are feeding on a wounded and enslaved dragon? Bloatflies are so gross. But I think that could maybe work for the Breath of Gorr. You know? Because if the Breath of Gorr is led by Gorr himself, the ancient ooze, then that could maybe make more sense. There's a bit more, like, decay and death going on, and whereas the Chastinol itself might be a bit more about blood, but then bloatflies are quite bloody, aren't they?
I just got this mental image of, like, Gorr or his avatar, like when I think of Nerul, it's like the big green reaper kind of thing. Gorr, I'm like this, like, top torso of, like, you know, an orc, like a nurgly looking orc, but, like, his bottom half is just this oozy, slimy, like, probably pseudopods that reach out and just consume everything.
Yeah. Oh, man. Dragon's name's still tied. Okay. Okay, let's see what else.
Roll for it.
Yeah, maybe we're all for it, yeah. Or we can just pick. I mean, perhaps the first time they meet her, she's just about to take the last step towards becoming a lich. The second time, she's completed the transformation and she's much more powerful. So maybe if they don't kill her the first time and they let her live there to save the dragon, perhaps, then she comes back later on in a campaign, you know, maybe in another adventure or another module we do. That could be interesting.
Ultimately, at the same time, we need to keep in mind the Shatternaut. Mm. It's not meant to be the final boss, right. I think. So if we like put all of the stuff on it, it might be overwhelming to a degree.
Sure.
That's just what I think as a writer, because writing modules, because I've once like gone crazy. Oh, this guy has this.
Yeah.
This is like one of the encounters.
I think what this kind of process can be for us, you know, so our chat is aware, is like we're getting all of these awesome ideas, mm-hmm. and then we'll probably go through an editing process, right? Mm-hmm. We've got all of this cool stuff, and we're going to throw all these ideas onto the wall, basically. And then some stuff will make the cut, and then some stuff will probably get edited, and we'll throw in our own ideas as well. But I do like the idea that we can just get all the stuff going. And maybe, you know, like we say, we move some of the stuff to the kind of the final boss of the module.
High-level adventure, it's not a level adventure. It's based on this, like, we're not using classes or levels or races to make the characters. We're just making them. And we're kind of test how we should skew the good guys to have it all make sense.
Yeah. So basically the idea that, like, you know, with low level stuff where you can't do cool stuff because, like, you have to use orcs, you have to use whatever, mm-hmm. we can now do cool stuff even though it's you know, aimed at beginners. I like the idea. The blood they've taken should have some effect on them, so players know who's on whose side. Black veins showing through the skin, eyes are bloodshot, black, sort of like, yeah, definitely a visual like manifestation of the power of the dragon. The flies and stuff could grow to a large size of blood and could be used as sustenance. Gross. Maybe they are her, like, maybe they're Captain Kor's, side. Like a henchman, almost, you know, like these flies that surround her.
Like, as the vampire, she has all those, and that, or she can turn into flies if we're still doing the vampire.
Ooh, maybe she could turn into maybe she could turn into a bloat fly because she can polymorph, you know.
Like vampires do, yeah.
Yeah.
Like she'll go up above the deck and be the flies, but then like we gotta find the captain. They see the flies start like materialize together.
Yeah, yeah. Ooh, that's gross. Turn into a.
It's like this nasty female orc with big old teeth. She's gonna be.
She's stanky. She's stanky.
She
can turn into this big, like, bloat fly creature. Oh, man. That's gross.
I'm going to have to make a mini out of that.
Maybe a vampire orc is trying to learn how to transform oneself into the black dragon. That's interesting. Could for fluff have part of the dragon where scales are ripped off and stored to armor the outside of the Shatternaut and they use magic to help regen and rip them off again? Ooh. I like different, like, area, like, inside the dragon. Like, this is a storage area, guys. Bloatflies are so gross. I agree, Webb. It's like, it's make me gag.
Especially if you look up YouTube videos of botfly larva removal.
Oh, bro.
Oh, that's the ones that lay eggs in the skin.
Why would you say that? But that could be an ability, you know, like, and here's another thing, like, and I, you know, this is a little, like, Lovecraftian inspired, I suppose. But, like, it could be that she, like, it's pretty gross. she could like infect the player with larvae and it hatches at some point or other. Oh man, that could be great.
Oh, like if it hatches and it's like it looks like the player, you know?
Oh.
Like this weird larval thing. That's like what she does as she dies. Like the captain of the first ship tries to sabotage this match before she dies, she like releases, like if she dies, like boom, there's like an explosion from her. All this, like, the spores, you know, or something.
Yeah,
have to roll, like, con saves. If they don't, then this, like, larva thing. And it's just there to freak everybody out.
Yeah. Oh, man. Like, let Mosquito win from One Punch Man. Yeah. The player should have the opportunity to shed their blood for Gorr to gain immense strength, but risk going under the ancient's influence. That's kind of cool. We have not yet picked a name. We've got three. We've got Yetranix, Nevranth, and Ferrisval all tied. Which one do you like out of those, Ron?
Yetrinik sounds more evil, I think. I think Neprenth and Therizval sound elvish and more like good dragon. Okay. Yetrinik has that evil sound.
Yeah, let's go for Yetrinik then. The voiceless dirge.
What that name? The red dragon? Arbanesh.
Arbanesh. Arbanesh and Yetrinik. That works. That works. Cool. I don't want to play no more too much Squig.
Yeah,
like casting Contagion. Oh, man. I tell you what, though, I would fucking love to, like, write a Call of Cthulhu module at some point, something like that. Oh, just do all this gross shit all of the time.
That'd be amazing.
There's a Pathfinder monster that impregnates character with his eggs and it bursts out a couple rounds later. Currently, I'm like, oh, that sounds gross. But yeah, basically some kind of ability like that. Ability to infest the PCs with her spawn.
It's like her death burst.
Absolutely. Okay, so we got the Captain of Shatternaut, Captain Core. Yeah, Captain of Shatternaut. Okay, cool. We've got Yetrix, the voices dirge. So let's go back to the Breath of Gorr. So this is like the main starting area. Right, yeah, it's your Black Pearl, the kind of starting area for that. What, and we've got the Ancient Ooze. This is a ship in which the Ancient Ooze Gorr himself, Gorr, the Ancient Ooze, as their god.
It's like one of his little summons.
Yeah.
Or that could be what the captain does to sink the ship. He does a thing and makes the ooze come up.
Oh yeah, I like that idea. I know the feeling, Gravity Geek. Worth all these larvae is mind control properties. That's a cool idea, yes, yeah. Almost like the charm effect of a vampire, but through the larvae, so you could almost...
I love it!
Yeah.
Because it's like, the way you get out is to like, scrape out the larva.
Oh! Or,
you suck it out,
That's mind control.
And, their faces look like the face of the PC. Oh, or of the player.
Yeah. Dun, dun, dun. Is Gorr the final boss at this point?
I think no. More like he'll have... It's like Gorr would be like the equivalent of like a Loth character or an Asmodeus thing. He could have like his ultimate agent. One that's there, like a high priest. But like he has influence and he has his little spawns he creates.
Sure.
Kind of like how giant spiders are Loth's thing.
Right. So he's not on the Breath of Gorr, it's himself, but his followers are. So
there's like a shrine room, that's where this is all at?
Yeah, okay. Not on the ship itself, but his followers are. Yeah, the great unclean one.
Nurgle is Nurgle. My favorite army in Warhammer.
They're pretty cool.
Maybe like his shrine room is like a like how there'll be fountains or something like that, but this has like the ooze in it, and they go pray to it, and it'll come out
and go over them. Yeah, it's pretty gross. It's a pretty gross campaign. So the Breath of Gorr is the starting ship. Let's get rid of this bold. The starting ship for the players. What if Gorr himself is a necrotic primordial? Gorr, bro. does not sound like a fun guy now. Now you put it that way, Steve.
If you NGI, he probably spread some of it.
Disease, blood chill. Although Gore's influence can transform creatures into ooze-like, the far more common method of creating these horrors is through the contraction of blood chill. Most contract this ailment after being subjected to attacks from the spawn of Gorr blood. Or of Gorr. Blood chill, contact, fortitude save, DC, whatever. Target loses 1d10 each hour, and if slain becomes a blood ooze. Ooh. That's kind of interesting. Okay. So like an over time, like disease kind of effect? Yeah.
Okay,
so we've got blood golems are the chosen blood of Gorr. They can be maybe like the main prison keepers. Like the guards, maybe.
They can be like you're like elite guys.
Yeah.
We want like little PUDs, which are regular orcs, you know. Maybe the step up from the PUDs.
Yeah.
And then,
maybe
like,
maybe these guys could be like the elite defenders of the captain in that case.
Yeah.
Of the ship, and then we've got standard orcs for lack of a better term, are guarding the PCs at the start of a campaign. Oh, start of the module.
I just thought of, did you ever see a Little Nemo in The Adventures of Slumberland?
I did not know.
Oh, there's like a part in that movie where Nemo, like there's this place underneath the big castle in the dream world, and you're not supposed to open this thing, and inside this big black ooze that like gets out and just starts grabbing everything.
Oh,
it's borderline terrifying.
When
you're an adult.
Fuck me, yeah. Okay, so you got Stand Orcs and Guardian of PCs. Let's start on the module. So, as we're beginning this module, the players are all prisoners aboard the prison ship. That's the basic premise that we're starting off, if you weren't here at the beginning. How are they kept prisoner? You know, is it a standard cell? Is it that they're kind of like kept prisoner by this disease, which is, you know, eating away at them? What is the elite defender separate from one being or something similar a la Dark Souls? That's kind of cool, because you just do split, you know, like they can split into two after you kill them, slay.
Oh, yeah. Oh, so yeah, if you kill like these enchanted guys. Yeah.
And can split into multiple enemies. I love that idea. Yes. Also, I would like, now that we're talking about it, Dark Souls would make for such an awesome setting for a D&D campaign. I can imagine that being great fun. Imprisoned by a mind spell. Okay, so how are the PCs imprisoned? I've got to see this link now. Oh, okay, yeah. Some reason I was thinking you were saying Finding Nemo, and I was like, I don't remember that, but it's been a while.
I was like, like that scene right there, it's like eventually that ooze comes to like this celebratory ballroom.
Yeah.
Oh God!
I like that. The players need to swim through an underground pool of slime to enter Gorr's inner sanctum.
Ooh, yeah, that's a good way to defend it. You just covered in the ooze.
Yeah, Gorr's inner sanctum is protected by the golems. And
I also think of that thing from Fern Gully Hexes before it becomes the smoke thing and he's like the weird sludge thing.
Yeah.
Slime beneath me, slime above.
We can't go through it. Let's see. Captain could have a pact of Gorr whose bond allows Gorr to issue his order through the captain. That makes sense. Yeah. They're suspended in ooze. I like that idea. How are they imprisoned? We also had like they are imprisoned by a mind spell as well. So, via mind control, something like that. Tainted love, da. That's what they're all listening to when they when they break into Gorr's in a sanctum. All the priests are like, tainted love. Da, da. Oh,
oh, that's like their chant.
I fucking love that. That'd be such a great sketch for a video. Holy Water, aka Pine Soul, will fill everything on the ship. So I like the idea that suspended in ooze. Yeah, suspended in ooze, and they immediately know. I mean, I think as well. Like, it's interesting to start off in a scenario which isn't like the same Morrowind, you're stuck in a prison, now you're out of the prison kind of thing. Like a more interesting jail and just like a standard kind of jail, you know.
Also, this kind of goes back to all core mechanics. If we do like 8 PCs, and it says you just give the PCs out randomly to the players, it's like you could end up with a team of like just brute force beat the door down.
It could be
a bunch of mages, could be a mix of both. And I think it'd be really cool to see how. If like, you know, okay, well, if we're just a bunch of beat the door down, then when this dragon lands on the ship,
exactly.
I'll fuck you up.
I like that idea as well. Like maybe you could even like roll, like I'd have a little table where like today I roll on the table. Now, oh God, now we've got a party of all mages, you know, all just the crazy ones. They awaken glued to the ceiling of the chamber. They need to struggle out their clothes to escape.
Ooh, naked.
Glued to the, getting some ERP in there. I see, grabbed a geek.
The breath of porn.
The vampire's very paranoid of aspirin. All right. Could the PCs be made mind slaves so the captors can use their mind power to propel the ship? Psychic rowers. Oh, so maybe they're not even like necessarily straight up in prison. Maybe they are
like fuel.
Yeah, fuel. Yeah. Controlled by the orcs, and made to row the ship. You know, it's similar to, like, you know, ancient Rome, ancient Greece, and once they get too tired and just can't row anymore, they die, you know? You know, they're sacrificed.
Check them overboard.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, yeah, like they're already being put to slave work.
Yeah, yeah. Or maybe, you know, maybe we start them off in their prison, you give them a scene to kind of, like, interact, and then they get taken off to like the rowing area, you know, like time to row, and then they have to go, and that can be their chance to escape, you know,
because we kind of need to push this idea of escaping, because the players might be okay, well, wait, obviously this is just the intro,
right,
get to where we're going, that's when
yeah, that's
the ancient dragon will attack and free us while we're about to be here.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think the way that we can do that as well is to encourage that, is make it obvious to them that they've overheard rumors that, you know, once they get there, they're all going to be killed or sacrificed to the dragon, you know, like, there is no time. Pray to Zeefling for following, a gentleman and a scholar. Thank you for joining us, my friend. If you guys haven't followed yet, by the way, hit that follow button and join us. Geez, how big is a ship on a dragon? Pretty damn big, I'd imagine, to hold all
pretty
of
these. Pretty damn big dragon.
Yeah. Shown like in Dark Crystal. Yeah, I like the idea of being used for energy in their body.
Gelflings.
Yeah, okay. So one of Lowe's ideas, basically, that August will run with, and then they will get a chance to escape. Presents itself. Whether that's they see a key like on an orc and they can like grab it quickly, or you know, a weapon is somehow thrusted into one of their hands, some other slaves are looking to break free as well, so you've got like a whole slave revolt going on in the like the rowing of the ship. That could be interesting. And then I like this idea as well. We had this thing down where the brig is a room full of ooze, so maybe if their initial attempt at escape fails, thanks Mo. No worries, man. If their initial attempt at escape could fail, you know, which is a possibility, and the PCs are, you know, TPK'd for lack of a better term, they get taken down to this brig, which is a room full of ooze. Which is a kind of, I mean, that could act as the kind of, if the party fuck up once, then you take them down to the brig. The second time they fuck up, they die, you know?
Yeah. And I like what Crafty Geek says, where the psychic rowers are, they're implanted with the bloatfly eggs. So maybe the party knows about the bloatfly eggs and they hate them already. And then when they do have a chance to kill, like, the one who's like, created the bloatfly eggs or whatever, they can put them, take this bitch out.
So in this case, the Breath of Gorr and Le Chatenor are both like allied, you know, they're working together, Captain Gorr and the captain of the Breath of Gorr. So yeah, you know, they're all on the same side, they're working together out of the frying pan into the fire. They are taken down to the brig, which is a room full of ooze, and then, you know, a second chance presents itself. Okay. An ooze torture room, yeah, where maybe you're like slowly ooze is like dripped onto you, and of course because it's acidic it will like slowly burn its way through you until like it comes out the other side, and that'd be pretty bad. Has it been covered how the dragon is being functionally kept alive? Perhaps obsolete prisoners and slaves are fed to it. The dragon is clearly an important resource. Yeah, we're onto the other ship at the moment. We're onto the Breath of Gorr, but when we were talking about the Chatenor, yeah, we had the idea that essentially it was being fed by like slaves, prisoners of war, basically, who get captured, and then the dragon goes nom nom when nom it gets nom. Hungry. Yeah.
Right.
Yep. So yeah, this is the Breath of Gorr, the initial starting ship for the players. What about the initial attempt? There we go. What about the Sanctum? You know, so is it the Orc Breeders? Yeah.
Sanctum.
Yeah. Okay, let's get these. Because this is the place that is like protected by the blood golems, almost like priests, guys. And the captain of the ship is here in this place where they're all, food is important, I agree, where they're all, like, worshipping him. who would we want the captain of the ship to be? Do you have any ideas for that room?
For the captain of the ship, let's see, what were these, have they done suggestions for the ship's captain?
No, not yet, no.
Okay.
So feel free to chat. So this is the captain of the ooze ship, not the dragon ship. Yeah. So is it like an ooze itself? Is it just an orc, maybe? I don't know.
What if it's a vampire spawn kind of thing from the captain of the Shatternaut?
I like that. So then the Shatternaut is like the parent ship almost.
Yeah, something like that. But like it's not like undead zombie kind of. Yeah, I also like the idea of, you know, like crap, you seem like a half, but like we can go with something a bit.
Yeah. More normal, yeah.
Yeah, more like why is this regular halfling or this regular whatever?
Yeah.
In charge? Like, what is it about him? And it could be like some kind of deep whatever.
Vampire triplets, tiefling.
Tiefling, yeah.
I like that idea, Bethlehem, yeah.
See, halfling, tiefling. Could be more of a monster kind of thing, like a gnoll.
Bugbear kind of thing.
Yeah, bugbear kind of guy, like big old brute. Maybe a bugbear kind of thing who has some kind of maybe magic with it.
Yeah.
Maybe some kind of blessing from Gorr, because a lot of these folks, like, you know, the reason they're doing all this is for the glory of Gorr,
right?
To get all this whatchamacallit.
Uh-huh.
So either, or maybe it's got a blood fly in it, and once you kill the captain, the blood fly emerges, and then they gotta fight that.
Can a halfling be a tiefling? No, they are separate. I guess you could probably have a halfling, half tiefling.
Or like a big fat blood fly sitting on the shoulder, you know? It's like a ranger pet that goes around.
Yeah. I love that idea of vampire spawn as well, Sean. That they spawn their captains to increase their fleet. So maybe, I mean, you know, we can... I don't know, what's this going on here?
So do we want to add a third faction? We have the Skull Nation, which is allied with the Spires of Kinrakus.
Right.
And maybe a nation, just like this one particular vampire.
Yeah.
That rather than being enslaved, like it got overthrown, she has thrown her hat into this ring and said, okay, fine, I'll give you captains, I'll give you use of my whatever, and that could be like either something for this or for a later thing is that vampire's actual castle.
Ooh, I love that idea.
Yeah.
So what if
that's where they're going there. Like, that's the prison camp.
Is the vampire's castle, yeah.
Yeah!
Yeah, I love that idea.
And that's why the Shadownaut is there. That's her own, the Shadownaut, it's her, like, you know, like, she's got this, that's why, like, so she's kind of, like, the one who, maybe she's letting a high Gorr priest be in the castle now, because they've taken it from her, more or less, and she's just like, okay, whatever, I get my boat, my dragon boat.
Okay.
Toot toot. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So we could do this another way as well. It could be that Captain Kor is also a vampire spawn and that it all leads back to this big vampire at the castle.
Yeah.
Or vampire spawn, yeah. So they don't have much control but has a bit more power, maybe.
And if they're female vampire spawns, then this main would be a male vampire?
Right.
Is that how it works?
I don't know. Honestly, but
yeah, it's our world.
It's our thing, yeah. I mean, that could make sense. If you've got two female vampire spawns, we could have a vampire dude. So,
like the vampire dude he's pledged himself to Gorr now. He's now got these powers, so his spawn are stronger. It's like Saruman and Sauron.
Yeah. Okay. A regular race person with an ooze-like avatar. I was thinking of skeletons being animated by the slime being involved somewhere, perhaps in the crew of the Breath of Gorr. Okay, that's a cool idea. While a vampire captain can become a swarm of bloatfires, but can infect people with bloatfire from a body to track them. We did have something like that for the Captain Kor. Yeah, I like that idea. So what, like, a instead of an orc, maybe like a halfling, like you're saying? Like a halfling vampire spawn?
And these can be like the brides of whatever the main vampire is.
Okay. Brides of the main vampire whose castle they are being taken back to.
Mm-hmm.
So this is becoming quite, you know, a little Curse of Strahd spin-off almost, you know? You
can probably work instead of being like dark and gothic, it's just nasty.
Yeah, yeah.
Just talking about the Mortal Kombat.
Oh, I don't. Yeah. Okay.
Or, let me find a picture of her and put it in chat.
Okay. Yeah, no, I haven't seen that one. We need some. We need some female vampire names, guys. And a male vampire name as well. Yeah. It's brides, and then you've got the captain's name here, a female, and then we've got the vamp, for lack of a better term, like vampire lord's name here.
She's kind of like a infested Kerrigan thing.
Oh, like, okay, yeah.
And Dariel.
Yeah. All right, kind of creepy actually. Huh, I like that.
Flip is gonna, I think, have a good time.
Oh, he is gonna love doing this, I think. Val for the female, the female captain. Okay, Val. No. I like that idea. Name's my biggest weakness. No, any vampire's biggest weakness. If I get a Pelotov for following as well, a gentleman and a scholar. It could be a lady vampire three wives. It could be.
Sure.
Vrikilla. That's amazing.
Or what if it's not even like a humanoid vampire thing? Like as if it's truly given itself over to Gorr.
Mm.
Like I'm trying to think of like a slug look. Oh, instead of snakes. Ooh. Like you want to see, it's like slug people. So it's like this giant. Think of like like the torso is kind of humanoid, but like the body's this big, grubby, like bloated thing, and it's just sitting up there, like
like a fat big.
Like on a tensor, it gets around on a tensor floating disc.
So like a like a slug like vampire spawn, but how about it's still the bride, like in a like a disgusting.
I mean, like the main, like the main one is that. That's the main one.
Oh, so you want... Oh, okay, right, okay. So you have
the main vampire.
Right, okay.
It even weirder if it's like a male, because it looks like an ant queen or a termite queen kind of thing, but it's like masculine. So you get into like that realm of like the weird... Like that androgynous sort of like the further down you go into...
Yeah, like Jabba. Jabba.
Yeah. Jabba Centaur.
Yes. Okay, Ciro for the male. Okay, Ciro. Decada. I like that. Ettore. For the male, I guess. Ettore, maybe? I don't know. Kiran. Yeah, I love the idea. It's a big jabber. And I think as well, like, what we could do with that is that we have the kind of... at the end of the module, you know, like, start getting there. And whether or not we actually want to do the Vampire Castle for the module itself could be another thing entirely. You know, we could have a castle... We could have the castle exploration being the part of the, you know, another module that we do down the line, because we could do a lot of that.
Have you heard of Kingdom Death?
I have heard of that. Yes, the big model.
It's got like these very terrifying looking models, monsters that come with it. Which I can't post like half of them in chat, so like Twitch stuff. But if you guys just Google image Kingdom Death monsters and see the creepy shit. It's like we can use that for all kinds of inspiration.
What's up, Ishman? How's it going? Yes. Okay. Cool. Dante, I like as well. All right, we've got some names down for our kind of like name bank, and we can pick one of those when we like to. Yeah. Okay. So maybe like the prison camp that they're coming to is this kind of vampire's castle. Would we want to do that in part of the Breath of Gorr module, or would you want that to be like a later one? Because I think you're going to go either way on it.
It could probably be a later one. Like in, so when they, their big thing is taking out maybe the Shatternaut. And then, or we could, this could be, can we extend, maybe if, it could be a Kickstarter goal. We reach this goal, we have to extend the deadline a bit, but we're going to add in the vampire thing. And if we reach this goal, so we can go from like a, a module to like a mini campaign, like a 3 or 4 session thing, if that's what it comes to.
Yeah. I like that idea a lot. Yeah. I love castles after all, so and Strahd based stuff is always sweet. Okay.
Especially this perverted.
Oh yes, Strahd we're doing here. Nice. I'm scared of pranks my roommate and my girlfriend. Oh man, yeah. Good luck for April Fool's things. I know. I'm sure there'll be some good stuff on the internet tomorrow. Okay, so that's the Captain of the Breath of Gorr. this female like halfling that is the bride of this slug like dude. Yeah. Got him imprisoned in this like ooze ship. And then I mean, let's talk about like the lair actions of the ship, you know? Yeah. Like what can, I guess the question could be, what can the Breath of Gorr do? We talked before about like the cannons of the dragon ship that are dripped in dragon's blood. What do the kind of ooze like, slightly more oozy, I guess.
A little more like gross, maggoty. And like when they take it over, it like the stuff kind of goes away because they're against Gorr. Gorr loses his sway. And they can destroy the shrine, it loses, like the lair actions don't happen. That could be a thing.
That's interesting. Yeah. If they can like sanctify it.
Yeah.
Ooze tentacles, of course. Ooze tentacles are a must. Ooze can trap people. Okay, so maybe with those same tentacles are what's used to trap folks aboard the ship. Yeah, I like that. To trap the PCs. So the weapons ship has big psychically controlled tentacles they use to attack other ships. Oh yeah, okay, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. The tentacles are used in place. It's basically this giant, like giant sailing kraken ship, basically. Which is pretty cool. Yes, the Breath of Gorr and the Shatternaut are different vessels. Yeah.
Yes, and we could play off Breath of Gorr, so maybe like some kind of like gaseous effect. Like,
Yeah, gaseous clouds. So the Breath of Gorr is like the ooze ship, and the Shatternaut is the dragon ship, basically. Can provide structures to shield enemies, spears, or at least slow down. I like that. Yeah. Mind you, had a pic I tweeted at you today. Oh yeah. yeah, I'm just a cool guy. I like that idea. Like, it's basically this floating kraken ship now, and it can just like spank people with its tentacles as it's going around, and maybe even use them as like oars. Maybe the oars are the tentacles as well.
Oh,
yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, and are used as oars. Maybe it's a dead creature.
Ooh, I got an idea.
And they're like pulling his dead corpse along.
What if like there's the Breath of Gorr, and then behind it, it's like trawling one or two smaller ships that have like your prisoners on it. And so it's like you bust out of that, shimmy over to the Breath of Gorr ship, and take it's trawling a bunch of other stuff with it. And that can, or that could be a thing where like, okay, we've taken them over, let's go check out what's in the cargo back here. So.
Fuck, yeah. So it's like dragging stuff along behind it all. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. It's going, Jen. Dragging, I don't know, cargo behind it so they can go and like loot the stuff afterwards. Mm-hmm. Breath of Gorr is its own defenses, vaporous abscess. Pus-filled lesions spewed acid upon those who get close who are not chosen by Gorr. Nice. Okay, yeah.
Nice.
Gaseous clouds. We'll call it vaporous abscess. That is a gross word. Spews acid.
See, if we're going more like a gooey ooze, then we could even change the name of Gorr to like lesion. That's, or well, no, I don't know. Gorr works. Gorr can work.
Yeah. Ew. Ooh, that pus breath though. Oh no. Cannot deal with that. It's turning into Call of Cthulhu. Yeah. Like a great. It's just turning into like my little bit like the Curse of Strahd campaign that we run with gross vampires and gooey stuff.
We take vampires and make them nasty.
Nasty vampires. Stanky vampires.
Stanky vampires.
Tentacular boil, dark swollen pustules bubble from the world skin and squirming growths wriggle within. On activation, a tentacular boil produces an Everard's black tentacle effect. Yeah, that's awesome. Ooh. Shorty, you gotta stop, yo. That's not right. It's not right. Yeah, it's super good at being disgusting. Almost too good.
Too good.
This conversation is so sensual. Yes, yes it is. Fuck me. Alright, that's pretty good for the Breath of Gorr. Tentacles that are like used as oars, and almost instead of cannibals you like slap people with the tentacles. And the vaporous and gaseous clouds that it exudes.
So our overall theme for like this is going to be like nasty organic stuff like that. That's going to be kind of like the takeover. Like I guess the ultimately like in the overall scheme of things.
Yeah.
What this does for this war going on is it's going to eliminate this vampiric ally of the Skull Nation. That's like what it is. Like they're trying to like get rid of. Okay, you know, Gorr has his influence. He's tainted this vampire thing and that. So that could be okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I like that a lot. You're single-handedly destroying the sexy vampire face, so I commend you. It's just doing my job.
it's not NC-17 if it's gross as shit.
Spawning spore.
From the U.S. censorship, if there's a nipple, if it's covered in sores,
it's fine.
It's fine. We can
send that shit out. PG-13. This massive tissue, when activated, spontaneously births an ooze to serve Gorr. Oh yeah. The ability to birth an ooze to serve Gorr. Yeah, gross.
Sets this mages and.
Yeah, I love the idea that when they get to this, you know, eventually they get to this castle place as well. And it's just like an oozy vampiric castle, you know, nothing like what they expected it to be. And it's just like fucked up.
One of the PCs is just like this beautiful female elf girl. Yeah. It's just like, you know, like that standard, you know, attractive elf.
Yeah.
Who is like, and like, it's more of like, okay, well, we're going to ally up because, you know, we have to team up to get out.
You know,
and so.
I love the idea of like someone, like Ishvan played a character who's like really OCD about being clean and. Things being clean. If someone's playing a character who's like needed things to be clean, or they couldn't be like in a room, and then you throw them into this campaign, it's like you get fucked.
It's like we'll put what's her name, the maid from Family Guy. It's clean. I clean.
Oh fuck me.
What's your motivation? I have to clean.
What's your alignment? Clean.
Clean.
Man.
No, I stay. I captain ship.
Fucking hell. Alright, so we've got how the PCs are imprisoned, we've got what the Breath of Gorr can do, we've got a captain of the Breath of Gorr, germaphobe, yeah. We've got the Shatternaut, Dragon, the Captain Core of the Shatternaut, and what can the Shatternaut do as well, which is pretty cool.
So it's all right. Like a ship hopping.
Yeah, it is a like a vampires type module now that it's shaping up in a way, isn't it? It's kind of cool. more lemon pledge. The crew can have to show their devotion to Gorr by cutting off an arm. In return, they get an ooze tentacle arm, which they consider a holy gift. Oh yeah, I like that. I like that. They like cut off like
the eyes of Grumps. They gouge out an eye, but they get powers.
Yeah,
and so
that could be the blood golems, you know.
Yeah. We have a limb pledge mage.
We've got a limb pledge. It's one of the pledge levels on Kickstarter. Cut off their arms.
You get like a free 8-ounce bottle of limb pledge with your pledge. For your eyes after you're done playing this module.
Yeah. Okay, with a tentacled appendage as a sign of Gorr's favor. Yeah, I like it. I like it a lot. Nega energy scab or Nega energy scab. Hard mineral laced mounds jut from the surface, thrumming with energy. On activation, a scab generates a line of harmful necrotic energy between itself and another scab. Ooh. Gross. Firefish, the same idea as the abscess thing. Okay, yeah. Okay. What's up, Trooper? How's it going?
It's really gross in here, Tree Pelt. Welcome
to the party. It's really gross. It's dark and dirty in here. I'll warn you. Okay, I love that. What can Breath of Gorr do? They've got the Shatternaut. Okay, what else do we need? What other parts of the campaign could we take a look at now? I feel like we've fleshed out some of these areas quite well.
What about the camp? Are we going to have the camp, or is it going to be built around the vampire?
Maybe it's built around the castle. Like
if we reach the stretch goal, we do the vampire castle. If not, then it's just the camp, and that could be like our main stretch.
Yeah,
goal.
I like that idea. Yeah.
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 We got to make them give us money for something.
The camera had to kick something.
We'll have to extend the deadline though of the release if we do that.
Yeah. Which, yeah.
That can happen.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so we've got the camp around the vampire castle, and of course the vampire castle itself. But the idea being that we've got like orc followers of Gorr that are like encamped around the castle because they're so enthralled by the fact that the vampire is in the castle, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we've got orcs camped outside the oozing castle. Which is a brilliant image of
like a moat of ooze and slime. Like Ganon's castle in the end of Ocarina of Time. It's above the lava pit, but it's above it's gonna be a lot of green.
Yeah, a lot of green, a lot of 420. A moat of ooze. They are followers of God, what's his name? Gorr, okay. Shouldn't be told, I don't remember. Followers of Gorr. And the PCs, they kind of plan to, I guess, destroy it, right, the camp?
Yeah, they were, just disrupt it. They could free prisoners, and, we freed prisoners and got, because in the camp, they're probably sacrificing shit.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
And all this kind of stuff.
Okay, yeah, orcs performing sacrifices. What else you guys in chat got? Tentacles flailing for the use to protection. I like that, yeah. Go ahead, Ram.
I was going to say, what if, like, these vampire characters use, like, these swarms of bloatflies, like, block out the sun above them so they can walk around in the day?
Ooh, you know? Oh, that's gross. So the orcs are vampire spawn, do you think? Or got some kind of...
Or they're, like, the vampire spawns that are, like, our named ones. Like, when they're, like, if they're, like, seen up on deck, there's, like, this swarm of flies surrounding them.
To kind of keep
them, like, in the shade.
In the shade, yeah. I like that. The orcs are petitioners wanting to sacrifice themselves to the moat of ooze to rise once more as blood golems. Oh, yeah. I love that idea. They are petitioners, yeah. Waiting to sacrifice themselves.
It's going to be so nasty.
To Gorr, yeah. This is not for the faint of heart. The castle was built on a plain, but since it's been subject to decades of damp, oozy corruption, it's turned into a marshy swamp. Yeah, okay, so it's got like swamp-like areas around it, this wet ground that isn't easy to... Eli asked on Twitter, is this an official module via WotC? Alas, no. Could a PC sneak onto one of the ships they've pirated to escape? I could see a bunch of people who never sailed trying to get away and stolen ship they've re-stolen. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think we're going to give them each motivations to go to the camp, though. So each character would have, like, you know, like a reason to stay, you know, a reason to want to, like, free their lost friend or get revenge on these orcs and whatnot. So they're willing to sacrifice themselves to Gorr and turn themselves into blood golems in turn.
What am I doing?
Good man, what's up, Seal? The camp has turned into a swampy marsh. Oh, I don't know, marshy swamp, yeah. Due to the
corruptions.
Swampy swamp, yeah. To the corruption of the ooze. Yeah, I like it. Okay. Half orc, half ooze guards patrolling the castle. I mean, the further they get towards like the castle as well, I mean, that could be an option for them to, you know, to enter into it. You know, they're going to face more tough combatants, most likely.
If we're going to get like all of these big giant dungeons and stuff, it might have extended the deadline in general and maybe up the price just a tad, like instead of like, oh, it's all digital.
Okay, Sean says you've got a creature. What, no vampire? So I like the idea of like, performing sacrifice and other prisoners there, so potential quest line for the party to save. What if someone like they knew that someone in the camp had vital information on like destroying the vampires, and that person was going to be, you know,
sacrificed,
and they got to save him. Yeah, save an NPC who has or knows of a way.
Like, what if it's like a divine being? Like it's an enemy. Like take like a good, very righteous kind of angelic creature that's in there. Maybe an ASMR, but like they know like, okay, well, this ASMR, even though we don't like it, it can fuck up these bad guys.
Right.
And it kind of brings like because we don't, it's kind of like everything is gross. Let's have this like beautiful kind of thing that's immune to all this stuff that is going to be sacrificed for Gorr. And if they can
free it.
Maybe on the breath of Gorr or somewhere they can find its like staff or its weapon.
And
like, you know, if we give it,
could lead them back.
Yeah. Or like, what if what if it's like an angel whose wings have been like cut off and they find its wings? You know? It's like if it gets its wings back. That way it can like fuck everything up and then go back to angel heaven. And so they don't, so it's not like we got a CR30 ally, just have it kill him.
It does
a cool thing, and it's, you know, whatever, boom. So
find
angel's wings. Or something along those lines. It could be anything.
Alright, okay.
Butterfly's wings.
I'll to bed so I can get up work. Good night, Noel. If you love your swords, and I'll tell you back at this. Oh, thanks so much, Laura. Have a good night. Enjoy, and talk to you. I'll be back on Sunday, so I'll see you then. PCs can get in to make this. Maybe fights to determine who gets sacrificed. Yes, then maybe like a kind of almost like an arena type deal that they've got going on. Castle is a giant hollowed out gelatinous cube. Now that's kind of an interesting idea. Maybe like the cube is like, well, it oozes like growing and
it's crusty.
Crusty. Ugh. It's stanky.
Let's say the vampires existed, and then when they surrendered over to Gorr, that's when it got all nasty. So it's probably still got like the original gothic looking vampire
architecture, setup. Yeah. And then,
but now instead of
it's got an extra crusty layer.
It's got film on it.
Free Fabio the SMR. Oh man, yeah, that's definitely this dungeon real quick. Okay, no, I like this. I like it.
And then when they do find the, it's something like bat, you know, like bats and stuff. It's worms and it's pretty good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
What if the vampire lord is like, he's just so bloated that it can't even move. You know? It's just kind of like trying to cast some spells out while it's got either like some underlings that they have to fight through, but he gets to it and
gross.
Like, like I said, what are the ways to kill the vampire that they can use against it? But like, change it to be like slugs.
Yeah. Oh, you think this be a horror campaign? Where is he? returning wings to the angel. You know.
I think like there's one more vampire spawn in there with it, and that's like the final boss, like it's caretaker bride.
Oh yeah.
And so they have to like go through her, and she can be like really sleek and, you know,
sexy.
What if she's even like just the regular vampire? Who hates that they've surrendered over to Gorr, but if we want to keep... Let's make it nasty. We can find more ways to make it nasty.
We need more ways. Death by undead heart disease. He's sitting on a gelatinous cube as his throne, This is a really nice little throne I've got going on here.
It's bouncy. It's like a waterbed.
I think I'll stay here. I like it, yeah. That's pretty good. We're gonna have a couple other quest lines going on in the camp, you know, ways for the party to disrupt and destroy.
So we've got like four main chunks. We have the Breath of Gorr, the Shatternaut, the Prison Camp, and the Vampire Castle.
Yep. Prison Camp.
Stuff.
Yeah. Shatternaut, Breath. Let me write that down for my own sanity. Revagor, Shatanor, and then we've got the prison camp, and then
potentially vampire castle.
Yeah, four, you know, question mark vampire castle. That could be a little extra stretchy thing that we do, because that could.
Shatanor might also be a stretch goal too, you know, because we have like Breath of Gorr, at least the camp. And we're like, with that, it's like a basic kind of cool module. Then we can add in the Shatternaut.
That's cool. And
the vampire castle.
Yeah. She's an old vampire crone who keeps the angel alive. Oh, so she. Maybe she's the hag whose eye the player character.
Oh,
has.
Yeah. Oh, what if he's the old hag?
Yeah.
You. Oh. And like. When she knows they're coming because he has her eye.
Yeah. Kukusi. Angel alive, and has been waiting, you know, for the PC, Boggs, to arrive, so that she can get her eye back.
I want my eye back.
Give me back my eye, young man.
Or what if the final vampire bride was like an ASMR?
Yeah.
But instead of like angel wings, it's not like those buggy wings, and it's like the fly around.
Yeah, like a big bug, but it's been turned into like a bug fly.
Like a stinger and
Yeah, incite a rebellion, yeah. Oh, man. I love it. All right, fantastic. I think we can, you know, work on this more, you know, next Friday maybe. We got actually quite a lot done.
We got a
boatload
done.
We got shit done, worked on, and a lot of good ideas thrashed out. So that's pretty great. I do have a second announcement for the day as well, which we're about to come out on Twitter as well. But in case you guys are interested, next Friday, because now that I think about it, next Friday we're doing a 12-hour charity stream, Dungeons & Dragons, of course. We're going to be playing a bunch of different games, a bunch of different players from the shows are coming on, and the charity is in aid of a recent friend. Who's passed away, and we're raising money in a scholarship fund in her name. So actually Sydney's cousin, I believe. So that's what we're doing next Friday. A bunch of people are going to be coming on, going to be having a good time and raising money next Friday. So you guys got a couple of minutes early, but there you go. But yeah, we will find some more time to work on the module, and of course Rem and I will be working on it offline, off the stream, and we'll be giving you guys updates on Twitter and the website, of course, and like Rem said, he plans to release the kind of box module proposal document, so you guys can read that on the website and you can look for all the stuff yourself and our ideas, and hopefully we'll be having more creative sessions where you guys will be able to write some stuff and to give us some more ideas and input as well. A couple of months still until the Kickstarter, but some exciting progress has been made today, I think, and hopefully you guys are excited. I know that I am, and Rem is as well. So if you did enjoy today's stream, guys, hit that follow button and join us. And Rem, do you want to give yourself a cheeky plug? Where can we find you online, my friend?
Yeah, you can find me go to the DM's Guild, look for Insomniacs Inc. I got modules for sale up there. If you like what comes out of my brain, check out the stuff I've already written. We also have links to them on the kind of roleplay section of the module section. We have two free mini modules, and then a few other more expanded upon ones with fancy arts and maps and what have yous. So check me out there, and hopefully you'll be checking me out in a few months or maybe this year when Breath of Gorr comes out.
Yeah, absolutely. One last thing as well, I did mention yesterday that I wanted to thank some folks for today. Also, again, another huge shout out to Shalom for sending me this awesome fucking dice bag. But also to Treepelt. Treepelt is one of the most avid, keen, to the point of she might actually be insane, the amount of Encounter Roleplay this lady's watched. Gone back and watched all of the VODs, she knows all of the shows and whatnot, the official librarian of Encounter Roleplay. For this
They're
month...
They're in charge of the wiki.
Yeah. For this month, crazy support from Treepelt, just being here every day, retweeting every single tweet, being here all the time, hanging out, helping us out in all sorts of ways. Treepelt, I'm going to send you a t-shirt for your support this month, an Encounter Roleplay t-shirt. Yeah. So you can pick a color, and you're going to get a shirt sent to you wherever it is you live. And hopefully that'll be with you in a little week or two, hopefully. So you can go find the merchandise here on our website, pick out a color that you like, and we'll send you a t-shirt. So you are the scholar of the month, we'll call it. So congratulations to Treefall for that, and thanks for all the support. Yeah, we're going to head off for today. It's been a fantastic month, guys. We're back on Sunday. You know, chill little Friday stream here. I like to keep it up on the Fridays. So we're back on Sunday once again with some more homebrew and review. And, of course, back with the Dungeon Masters Workshop soon as well. Hopefully you guys have enjoyed today's stream and the whole month of stream, really. Exciting charity stream next Friday coming along. 12 hours of Dungeons & Dragons and shit ton of new shows and new ideas coming very soon, including the Breath of Gorr. So get hyped, and I want a sticker. All right, we'll find you like a kind of loyalty badge or something like that. But yeah, other than that, guys, hopefully you enjoyed tonight's show, and until next time, try not to throw too many net ones, because we want to be here laughing when you do. Good night, everybody.